Christmas is over. No, that's not a good way to start. Welcome to the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. We're here. This is the last episode of 2023 being recorded, but it's not the last episode I'm recording this year. But it's our Christmas party. We've got two guests on that have been on, well, only once been on the show before, Kyle, as part of our, I think it was some sort of celebration episode of the podcast. But for the first time on the SWN podcast, it's Kayleigh as well. K and K reunited on podcast.
Finally, also my cat's about to get in front of the screen, so I need to move him.
Oh, we'll get him in. Yeah, then.
No,
oh,
he
scared me.
That's it. So this episode is for our a bit of a Christmas party, a bit of a talk about Scottish wrestling this year, and we'll also somehow go through the award categories for the SWN Year End Awards, which will be going out on the 1st of January. The voting form will go out. If you're on Patreon, you should already have access to it, but you'll already listen to this episode about 3 weeks before everything else goes out anyway. So there's lots of awards. My internet has gone unstable. That's a perfect thing to do. Are we back? Hopefully we're back on internet. Fuck you.
Yep.
This is going well. So yeah, how are you guys doing?
All right.
Yeah, getting by, I suppose. It's been fun and games. Don't know how Christmas was, because it's coming out after, but...
I'm going to say it was great.
I hope so.
You got all the presents you always wanted.
Oh, yeah. All I want is food, really. So I'm after.
All the Goldberg merch available.
I'm just going to leave. I was not going to stay. I'm just going to go. I'm going to get bullied.
I mean, the night is young. Yeah, you probably will be. Anyway, so it's been an interesting year of Scottish wrestling. Of course, I did our year end awards last year that got accused of bias and some issues somehow, you know, so much so that we sold one t-shirt that said rig polls arrive, rig polls leave. So thank you, Kwaku, for being the only person to buy it. Thank you. You guys have probably went to more shows than I have. You certainly have went to more shows than I have this year, because, you know, I've only went to one on a train. The rest of them have been within driving distance of. So just overall, just how's your wrestling year been?
Well, we spent too much money on wrestling.
Oh, yeah. I know. I even forgot about, like, the non-local Scottish wrestling stuff, yeah.
Yeah. We went to a lot of local shows, but we also ended up going to London
twice for
AEW. Rev Pro and Money in the Bank, which was all class. But we went a lot of local stuff.
You know the gif or the clip of Joe Exotic where he's like, I'm never going to financially recover from this. That's essentially how we're feeling right now.
Yeah.
From last year's shenanigans. But yeah, no, it was good. But on the Scottish scene, like, yeah, we've ticked off a lot of promotions this year, to be fair. Yeah. Like CPW, Iron Girders, obviously Bleeding Gums is a new one, and then obviously WrestleZone and Disco that we've been to before. But yeah, we've ticked off a good few, which has been quite nice, to be honest, just to get a bit of change.
Wanted to go to more, but we don't drive just now, so it's a pain in the hoop.
Is that 2024's plan, is to get one of you to be able to drive?
Yeah, well, hopefully, and then we can go to more places. Because everywhere I'll look at somewhere, I'm like, oh, that's a cool place to go, and I'm like, oh, that's in the arse end of nowhere. Sorry, I just realised I didn't sign up, sorry. But yeah, I can't get to it, and I'm like, it's not worth, like, 9 hours travel.
Swearing is not an issue now. I stopped that a long time ago, because I couldn't be arsed editing it out, and it just made everyone else clam up when I said no swearing, and they just automatically just went, I won't say anything at all, because I'm too scared I'll actually swear instead. But no, yeah, for this year, WrestleZone, of course, been to quite a few, because I'm part of the Aberdeen Wankathon. Did CPW as well, when they came up to Peterhead, W3L as well. They came up twice. So, Fair City. There's Fair City Wrestling as well in Dundee, which was weird, because I haven't been to the Ardler Complex since the other place was there. I think last time I was on, it was at the Ardler Complex, I was on the show as well, in an ill-fitting suit. Guy. Yeah, that's the last time I was in the Ardler Complex before then, and it was just, yeah, it was a weird place. Like, it just looks exactly the same, and just as creepy.
Kyle's got pizza coming, so he's a
Men
bit
are
nervous.
assholes.
Sweet.
So yeah, that's kind of obviously I haven't seen you guys for a while either because of all your gallivanting as well.
Yeah.
Trips up north are a little bit less available.
Yeah, it's been insane. So we were meant to go for Halloween, but then we had a gig or something. I can't remember. We had something we had to go to. What gig did we go to instead of Halloween?
It
Was Fallout Boy, wasn't it?
was
It was
fun.
Fallout Boy, so of course Fallout Boy took president. And then the last show, Kyle's parents came to visit us and have like a day out with us and stuff. It's the only time they could meet up with us. So they came down to Glasgow, so it'd be a wee bit crap if we went all the way up to Aberdeen as they came down. But I think we're trying to get to the show in next year.
Yeah, I don't see any issues,
We've
to be
checked our
honest.
calendar, it's going to be free.
Do we know what date it is?
January 20th is. As soon as I told Kelly about it, told her about the end of the last show with Ronan and Connor now being a duo in WrestleZone and looking like they're taking on Aspen and Caleb. I
Yeah,
got home. I got home the next day. Oh, got home and saw her the next day. She went, I've already asked my mum if she'll take Jack for that night because I want to go see that. Cool. I was gonna ask, but I don't need to, so that's fine. So
I
yeah,
think
so.
it'll be fast, but then they also spoiled it because they went, oh, Connor's going for the title, might win it, but then they released a poster for the next show where Aspen's still holding the title.
Yeah,
So.
there was that. I mean, at least like a couple of years back, they did that with Crusher and Aspen, and then at the same time, they put out a poster with Crusher holding the belt for hijinks, and Aspen then put out a separate poster with him holding the belt as well. So I was like, oh, who could win? But yeah, that was, it felt like a placeholder. I hope that's not the final poster because I think if they're trying to get more folk into a bigger venue,
Yeah.
possibly need to show more people that's on the show to get folk in, maybe.
100%. Well, I've never been, of course, I've never been to that venue. I've only been to places WrestleZone I've been to before, but it's near your parents' house, isn't it?
Yeah, because it's on, am I right in saying it's Ellen Road, isn't it? Near the barracks, that new
Apparently
venue.
so. Yeah, I have no idea where it is. I had to like zoom out, and I thought that's quite near like Langstrath and all that kind of stuff. So I think it's not too far from like your curl and all that kind of stuff. But I have no idea. I'm gonna have the wee sat nav out of my phone while Kelly tries to find the place. That's kind of how it's
We
gonna work out. And then hope for the best.
country bumpkin, you know what I mean?
Oh,
Lots of big
jeez.
smoke. Big smoke.
Aberdeen still scares me when I go there. Just in the high street. Oh my God, there's so many big things here. This is too
Oh,
much,
Aberdeen
too
scares me.
pressure.
But for different reasons, Aberdeen scares me.
Well, funnily enough, if I've got my dates correct, that is the night after the Ruggie Rumble,
The Ruggie Rumble. You
which
heard about this?
which will be our APW first time going there. So yeah, so it'll be a good weekend actually.
Kyle has a soft spot for Ruggie since we used to live there, and he always said he would love to have a show in Ruggie, and now someone does actually host a show in Ruggie. Blow his mind.
Also, I will say though, right, I wish I trademarked it because when we used to have like people over to our flat to watch like pay-per-views, I would call them like Ruggie Mania, Ruggie Rumble, Ruggie Slam, which is what they've just done.
Yeah, I used to make signs and everything. I used to make, like, you know, the WrestleMania sign. I used to make them, put them on like our living room and all that, and sit behind us. I'm pure sad, aren't I? And everyone would come over. And I once made a wrestling ring cake. It wasn't as good as I'm trying to make out to be. Bit terrible. It was just a square cake, and I put chocolate fingers in the corners, strawberry laces around it for ring ropes. I thought I was Mary Berry. It's funny to me.
Well, I kind of like their name. Have you seen the poster for Bound for Wishaw? Which
Brilliant.
I don't know. There's a point where it looks so, it's one of those things where it looks so bad, it's actually good. It kind of goes roundabout again. It's like Ronin's merch, but he puts out some absolutely shit terrible merch, and you look at it and go, "That's actually genius." I mean, it looks awful at the same time.
Yeah.
It just doesn't compute with the mind. So yeah, APW. I featured them quite early on just because of the guys they had on. I kind of put a lot of stock into if Luke King Sharp or Ravy Davies work the show. I think I'm fairly safe. There's not going to be any wrong-ins on the show, so I was
Well,
quite happy to do them.
they're obviously quite closely linked with CPW. And Davey's obviously got his head screwed on with that stuff. So I think you're pretty safe there, to be fair.
Oh yeah, because I've already got promotions that are in the amber zone, and then middle just waiting. I'm waiting for them to put on someone that I can just go, that you're out. That's you're shuffled away.
It is a thing now though with Scottish wrestling, because like, even with like Bleeding Gums and stuff, obviously I know Andrew and that, and when the show was kind of getting booked and stuff, everyone's kind of looking at it going, what's a new wrestling promotion? Are they going to have the pedos on? And then we're just kind of like, oh, you never know. And then I'm like, no, it's fine. You won't. You're all good. But I think you have to have like that first show just to prove to everyone that like, no, we're fine. Like you're good.
Isn't it mental that we're in a place where you have to prove you're not a pedo? It should just be a given. Don't be a pedo. But
No, there's those certain names that pop up though that you just go, so and so's announced,
yeah.
pedo's behind that, then let's just
A big
move
neck.
on.
Like, see at this point, see if you're just an out there pedo, just fuck off. Like, just go away. We don't want to see you. But that's just my opinion. Do you know what I mean? Who am I to
I
say?
mean, to be fair, I think we're throwing the pedo around word around about much, but
Just an audience in general.
in terms of just general wankers, yeah,
Yeah.
there's a lot
Yeah.
of them. But
I
good
mean,
choice.
shouldn't be putting up pictures of them training like 12-year-old girls, you know, that kind of thing. That's just, you know,
You think?
yeah, that's just maybe if he hadn't spent months getting outed and called out for that kind of thing, maybe not appear in those kind of photos. That's probably a good resolution for anyone who is possibly doing that. We will not name anyone because I don't want to be
Is
seared.
it? Why does that feel like a Tim Robinson thing? Do you think you have to think about it? It's obvious. Yeah.
Oh, Jesus Christ. So for anyone who's got the chronological line of me being ill at right now, it started with the WrestleZone recap, which I sounded like I'd smoked 6 day a day. Then you get to jump to the Christmas Chaos episode where I was just about ill at the first half, then ill on the second half. And then way back into the future, Legends Never Die episode, where somehow, because I was high on painkillers, we got our shirts off at the end of the episode and tweeted The Rock. So I don't know why that particularly happened, but so this is the end of that week, and we're all over the place as this podcast goes. Anyway, right.
I'm assuming like if we're breaking the fourth wall, I'm assuming you've just like recorded the Legends Never Die one.
I
I've not
recorded
seen
it
that yet.
last night. Yeah, I recorded it last night, and just
Good guys.
for context, I had to put the video on Patreon as well because I don't think it makes sense if we're just like scrambling at one point because we're all taking our shirts off. There is a reason why, I think. I hope it's in the episode we explained why, or if it was off the recording, it
Okay.
might be even more awkward. But it's fine. You don't see a lot of me on the because this is as much as you get. So don't be afraid.
Is
Anyway,
it was that related to like the Chuck Taylor
that's it.
like
That was it.
Facebook?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, because we all tried to message The Rock on Instagram, but he doesn't take in incoming messages
That's
anymore.
why.
Well, because
Maybe
idiots then send him shirtless photos. That's probably why.
same, but he answered my DMs. Joking.
I wasn't really paying attention to what you said there, to be honest. I was.
Said when I sit on topless photos answered my DMs.
Well, fair play.
Don't get any
Anyway.
ideas, people. This is I was gonna say a PG show, but we've already mentioned pedos, so I don't think that's really applicable. Right, so yeah, year-end awards is kind of what we're hoping to try and discuss tonight, while we can, while we're all some sort of awake. I don't want to do a Vago and pass out during an episode of the podcast. That would be wholly unprofessional. So we'll start with the big one because we'll probably have answers for it, which is the wrestler of the year. One. So this year there was a lot of chatter. Well, not a lot of. It was me chattering to myself on interweb that I was going to merge the category. So instead of male and female, it would just be one wrestler of the year. And I think I'm going to do that. So it's just going to be one wrestler of the year, but we'll do a top 10 of who's voted. So hopefully, because I have a feeling that if we do just wrestler of the year, it's going to be a man that gets voted. So at least if I do a top 10 list, it should hopefully throw in a kind of couple genders in there. That would be the hope and prayer, because otherwise I don't want to be also biased of Aberdeen and sexist at the same time, even though I don't vote in my own awards, but I know
Well,
that that's a possibility that I could be called sexist.
Well, according to your, Instagram stories, and that question thing,
That's my
you hate
answer.
women apparently. That's
That was so annoying because, like, I don't know how I came to the conclusion. If anything, I give some of the female some female wrestlers and male wrestlers way more credit than they should get. So, fuck
I've been
you.
on record and I hate women, and no one comes after me. Not all women.
Well,
Not all
anyway,
women.
swiftly swerving from that one, but because I kind of spoke to you about this at the time, like, I get that obviously you cover all of Scottish wrestling, right? But you are based, like, is pretty much as far north as you can go without living in a shack, right? So like, the expectation for people who are like, oh well, how has he not seen all this? I'm like, well, because a lot of promotions don't put their stuff out online, and if you're not going to the show, you're not going to see these people, and there's not really much in the way of like women's wrestling and like wrestlers and stuff just now. So like, if you're not going to the shows where they're happening, like, you can't really
Yeah.
have an opinion.
People
But
are terrible at using social media and then complaining how no one saw their stuff. Well, how do you expect people to see you? I'm not going to travel for hours and pay money for something that I don't know anything about, apart from seeing maybe a poster if I'm lucky.
that's
Like,
it. Because there's guys that I've really took a shine to this year that I may have seen two matches of on YouTube, but because of their online social content, I'm invested in them as characters. So if they come up north, if they're at CPW or if they're at WrestleZone, I'll be like, oh well, I definitely need to go to the show because I want to see that person wrestle.
yeah.
So yeah, online content is probably the most important thing because, like you're saying, I mean, what companies really do put their stuff online? CPW do, but sometimes it's months after the fact.
Yeah.
Iron Girders are usually pretty shit hot at putting their stuff out.
Yep.
Pro 2, they put out something every couple of weeks, so do Fair City. This goes so behind, but apparently they were sorting something soon for putting shows out. So yeah, there's at WrestleZone, they're on still on DVDs.
You
So
have to get, they actually write a transcript of the show, what happened, play by play, and they send it by carrier pigeon. That's how you watch wrestling now.
Well, I mean, you could just watch the you could just watch the road trip episode of the SWN podcast. And you do get a nice montage
Exactly.
of the show. Sometimes video, mostly photos.
Now I would have to go out and buy a DVD player just for one thing.
I can't remember the last time I played a DVD, to be honest. Oh,
Why
hang
doesn't
on.
one this?
You seem to have some interference.
Oh no.
Hello. It's that time of year. You know what it means. I've got a question. Kayleigh, would you rather have unlimited bacon,
What
but
for?
no video games, or games, unlimited games, but no games?
I've been asked this question more times than I want to be admit, because you have made him ask me it numerous times.
Yeah,
This
and
is an obvious
I've
question.
not heard the answer yet.
Don't, because I'm too no right in the heat that I'm
It's
going
a
to
simple question.
in my ears.
Okay, it's just two options. So would
Okay.
you rather have option one,
Okay.
unlimited bacon,
Yep.
no games?
Okay.
Option two, games,
Yeah.
unlimited games,
Okay.
but no games.
I think I'd choose the bacon.
Love it. Okay. I just
Have to have the bacon. I'll get
there's no
bacon.
games in that
Yeah.
option. I just
And I'm so disappointed in myself. Anyway, he's back.
He's
Yep.
back. So we haven't actually introduced for people that are listening to the podcast and not watching the video. Ian Skinner has arrived to the podcast for I think his first appearance in season six. So I think you're now one of seasons. Yeah, well, yeah, I guess. Not being a Scottish wrestler, it seems. I get, this is a cameo appearance.
I suppose that because this will come out after the SWN 150
Have you
comes
got a
out,
Liquid Death
so
sponsorship? Can you get me some more water? Liquid Death. Oh, it's water. It's in a can. It's less recycling. It just tastes like mountain spring water. Brutally murder your thirst. Get a sponsorship. It's
why don't
just
you just drink for your tap?
look, it's a can. Are you trying to get in the way of Billy's money right now?
The
I'm
only
trying to
thing
get
I
him
haven't
a
got
sponsor.
sponsored, I've still got Manscaped. 20%
You've
off now.
how?
How?
No, Billy, no.
Billy, I don't want to hear about you shaving your balls one more time.
How do you still have Manscaped?
The
Did
coastal
you not
works.
like
Yeah, I spilt a can of Monster and was cleaning it up while you were doing an ad read last time. Actually, no, your ad read sucked ass. I had to do the ad read for you.
All my ad reads have been terrible, and yet my code still works. So SWN20, if you go to manscaped.com, 20% off. Free delivery.
Was that the lawnmower 4.0 that you had in your hand there?
Yes, it is. I don't have the reed in front of me either, but yes, it is. And it trims everything nice and close.
Wow.
That's the best read you've done.
Listen, I still don't want to hear about it.
Well, it's the best read he's done so far, but he's not even mentioned yet the
cream?
The crop reviver.
I don't have that in front of me. That's in another room.
It's deodorant, but for your balls. Or the crop preserver, which is a pH balancer. And as well, with the performance package, you do get a free nose hair trimmer, which, as a new dad, how old is he now? Like 14?
16 months.
16, Jesus, that's like...
14. Feels it.
As if 14 months, when you say 16 months, it's okay. Sorry, when I say 14 months, I'm a little bit 14. Off base.
He said 14, full stop.
Yeah, I was going to say months.
All right, sorry.
It'd be silly to start going, is he 1 year old? Because, of course, he is. It's been 1 year.
You haven't even talked about the handy carry travel case that comes in as well.
Oh, the leather bound travel case. That's incredible. Where'd you get pizza from?
You're going to take that on like day trips with you.
Where'd you get pizza? Yes. See, Kayleigh's in on it now. Bro, you can take.
I took it with me to Fair City Wrestling on the train to Ardlermania.
Fair City Wrestling, just sit there and get your boss it.
I was in a hotel beforehand. I wanted to make sure I was comfortable after being in a train the whole
day. You know, like when teenage girls would like, oh, I need to make sure if I'm going to see One Direction that I'm wearing my nice underwear just in case I get pulled up on stage by Harry Styles.
You never know.
Yeah, I mean,
where'd
I
get pizza from?
I could have been in the ring at some point.
Where'd you get pizza from?
Domino's.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you're but I'm not a good judge because it's just a ham pizza. I love ham.
And yet the bacon and games question was wrong, but you're going to eat a ham pizza in my face. In my Italian face, you're going to say, oh, we're going to have ham on a pizza. Not even prosciutto.
What? I don't speak Tory. What are you talking about?
What do you mean I don't speak Tory? Are you calling all Italians Tories?
Well,
just because I choose meat that isn't just from the deli. Well, actually, it is from the deli, but from a good deli, not from a Tesco deli. Actually, you could probably get prosciutto from a Tesco or like Asda or Morrison's. I'm still listing shops. No, I was actually done listing shops. Asda, Tesco, Morrison's.
Is Lidl.
What?
Lidl.
A Lidl deli?
No, they've got their own.
What is this? A deli for ants? Thank you.
Are you off out, Ian? Just out of curiosity, because you're wearing your jacket.
Yeah. Well, I need to get fresh air at some point. I know it's cold, but I'm scared.
Oh.
As we all should be.
Just outdoors or being inside all time.
The penguin is hurt, Billy. I don't know what happened. It was something to do with Catwoman, some stairs. I'm really concerned about the penguin.
Yes.
Okay. Does anyone understand? I don't understand.
Just the penguin's hurt. Ask
I still haven't watched the Batman.
It's a new Reddit AMA. Ask me anything and then I'll go.
Did you watch the Gotham series? That was good.
Okay, I don't want to talk about the Gotham series because the Penguin is hurt right now, and I don't know what happened. Something to do with stairs. Something to do with Catwoman. The Penguin is hurt. I think me and Kyle are organizing next week a day to go visit him in hospital.
That's so nice of you.
Yeah. Oh. It's gonna be tough, but we'll pull through.
That's good.
Yeah.
That's
good. He's really hurt.
His very own make a wish.
Here's a real question for you, right? A real journalist over here, unlike Mr. Strachan, the balls rod, right?
Is that a Star Wars t-shirt?
Yeah.
I see. Like, imagine if it was just like a Friends T-shirt, but instead of Matthew Perry, it was Chewbacca.
That could work.
Okay.
They're doing Christmas carols. It's fun, isn't it?
What did you just say? Sorry, what?
It's fun.
It's off. Sorry, you're gonna have to say that again. I think I must have. What did you just fucking say?
I'm gonna be sick. Oh, you're
sorry, scared. Kyle.
Love it.
No, it's fine. I was gonna ask. You know, with you being so, you know, invested in softcore just now, right, and how closely linked they are to the battle rap scene. When will we be seeing your first battle rap? That's my real question for you, mate.
Well, I keep bothering Shotty to be like, here's the thing, I'm not sure about where my first battle rap is, but I do want to be in the background of one going, oh, but like from like the most mid bars. I'd probably get kicked out, like proper, like, because every now and then, like, they'll be mid-bar and they'll... My favourite thing about battle rap is it just... Oh, shit! Oh! That Conor McGregor thing was weird, wasn't it? And at least we now know where he draws the line. You know, you can take the piss out of his money, you can take the piss out of, like, his family, you can take the piss out of, like, just... being knocked out in the UFC, but don't bloody mention a poppy, all right? That's where he draws the line. Bold, sharpie.
So Soft Pro, from what I've seen, is such a, it's like a multiverse place, because of course Les Battersby is coming soon there as well.
Huh.
It's such a, like, I don't think, if you try to predict what happens at Soft Pro, like, you can't. Because that's just, it just seems like the fucking Wild West of wrestling at the moment, but in like a good way, where you walk in and go, oh shit, there's fucking Les smoking. And then you turn around and they go, oh, they're trying to fight Conor McGregor in a battle rap. It's like, what world have we entered? It's, yeah. it's amazing.
Yeah.
There you go, that's my journalistic thing.
Why were there 10 people in the Crown Cup match? That's...
Well, because 9 was too little and 11 was too many, I'd imagine. That's...
Liquid Death, brutally murder you first. It's canned water.
Auntie Donna who do?
Yeah. Liquid Death, canned water.
So try to punt your canned water.
It's not my canned water. I just think it'd be a good sponsor, and you see a lot of people get sponsored by it. Listen, I'm not going to have any more questions, okay, Kayleigh? Okay.
You get sponsored by Domino's?
Okay. Wait, oh, yeah, Domino's. We should have advertised the energy drink. Was it Sneak?
Yeah. Well, have you tried Sneak?
Was that the one you were
because Sneak tastes like ass. I've been punting for a while. Gamer Sups. They've got
the white one.
Titty milk. Yeah.
Yeah. There's one I had to edit out. One of the only times I've had to edit out an episode because you kept saying a certain word.
Oh, yeah. Bruh. Yeah.
Yeah, bruh. That's the word.
I felt that I was saying that word too much. It was cum. Fuck it. It's a Christmas episode.
White Christmas.
That's where I draw the line, okay? Anyway, have a good Christmas, y'all.
Merry Christmas, number 163 in Scotland.
Yes. in Scotland.
Number one in our hearts, though.
Hey, that's pretty good. Bleeding Gums, death match, more like my name, Jeff match.
That's you'd say there's...
What jokes did I do before this?
That's one of the greatest cameos. That might be the best. I don't know how many cameos you've had, Billy, but that's definitely the best.
To the door next.
I'm trying to think. I think that may be the only one I've organised. So unless you guys have been punting the link since we started.
I could punt the link.
Well, so yeah, that's,
Oh,
okay.
Absolutely not. Because you never know who you'd get.
Like a
I'll be
house
fine out all your pals. You're making it bleeding gums as well. And I'm all right with not having them on the show because
party.
I don't want to speak about deathmatch wrestling.
Nice
Just disappear.
men, nice boys, fun time.
Yeah, but I mean, you saw Billy cringe at the idea of half the stuff they were done.
Pussy.
I didn't mind, like, most of it I could get on board, like, not get on board with, but I don't know why, but the nettles was the one that scared me the most. Like, that's chemical warfare. That's not right.
Grass man, the man who got.
Do you know the worst part was there were no nettles on that show.
No, they weren't on the best part. The best part, the most underrated part of that match was when they had the terracotta pots, and when they smashed into them, Gary beside me shouted, "Oh, he's just battered Bill and Ben." Tickled me. Tickled me more than it should have. That was good. Well, he had to be there, sort of thing.
Well, it should be online
I've got, I
soon.
should have been a fat kid.
So, well, we'll try to steer ourselves back onto the reason we're here, because we're about half an hour in. We haven't actually talked about any of the categories really yet, because Ian jumped in for 5 minutes and was Ian Skinner. As you may have heard briefly, that he is in the SWN 150 this year. He is number 163, so he has not made the cut. Sadly, that's because now he's a British wrestler now. He's not a Scottish wrestler. He's a British wrestler.
That makes
So
sense.
it's a damn shame that Scotland haven't capitalized on Ian Skinner. Wrestler of the year then. So last few years, well, last year it was Aspen was wrestler of the year for the male side of things, and Emerson Jane was the wrestler of the year for the female side of things. We're merging the category this year. It's now just be wrestler of the year. So we get to decide. Well, we don't decide. We are putting out ideas, hopefully, for people to go, oh, I can't think of one. Oh, these guys have somehow mentioned a few folk that may be worthy of a vote. I don't know if you guys have written down any possibilities of people that you've enjoyed watching this year, thinks they've had a good year in general,
Mate,
that
I've
could.
had chance of living. You go first.
Oh, okay. Right. Well, because, and this is where I get accused of being a woman hater as well. I just assumed that this was the male category, right? So there's a few now that I've kept in mind. Because I think if we're going overall wrestler, I mean, it's hard to not argue for Emerson because she's done it all this year. And before the end of the year, she's making her debut in GCW over in America. Do you know what I mean? Like, that's the level we're talking. Like, she's
Yeah.
been amazing. Again, she's done some silly things this year. Her deathmatch with Rina Yamashita was
Oh, so good.
unbelievable. But also some of the people that I thought, I mean, Caleb Valhalla is a belter of a shout. I think he's taken it to the next level this year. He's always been good. He's always been, he's had a good aura about him. But I think this year he's really taken it to the next level in different ways. Because like the whole like entertaining stuff with Aspen and Discovery and stuff, and then like the more serious stuff and like WrestleZone Fair Sight, all that sort of stuff. So yeah, I think those two are probably at the top of my list.
No, I agree. Emerson 100%, I think, for female of the year. I just threw, you kind of said everything. She's done it all and she's entertaining to watch, which I think is half the battle, because she does a wee bit of everything, basically. And spoiler, I'll talk about her later on in the list. But for me, there were loads of people. So there's, I saw a lot of things online, not everything online, because as we spoke about earlier on, not everyone puts everything online. But see, when I was thinking about it, see, out of all the matches that I've enjoyed the most this year, there was one sort of common denominator in them. So my wrestler for the year is actually Zach Dynamite.
I know when you were just about to say that, my brain just went, I think Zach probably should be thrown in there as well. And yeah, absolutely. Zach Dynamite is, from matches I've seen as well, not just live, but ones I have seen online, that he's just another level this year, it seems.
100%. Well, let's put it this way, like, I think he gets looked over a wee bit, see, because he's always consistently good. So people are like, oh, someone maybe is like taking a step up, so they will like stand out in your expectations, and you're like, oh, you really notice them. But someone who's always consistently good is Zach. And there's something about this year, like, I again haven't saw him live, like, I know more of him now than ever, sort of thing. But what I was saying is, like, over the last year, everything has such intensity to what he's doing. Like, every single match he had, you believed it. And whether that was WrestleZone's majority of the places I've saw him, and again, everything had such intensity, you believed what he was doing. But even then, when you take it to Disco, he did a bit of everything. He had like some more like comedy style matches with the boys, and he still has some like really intense matches on his own. And I just, yeah, when I was looking at it, like 9 times out of 10, when I leave a WrestleZone show, more than anything, the match of the night he's been involved in some sort of capacity, and I think that says a lot.
Absolutely agree with those three that you've mentioned there. Emerson, not just because of what she's done elsewhere, but of course, Impact debut as well in Glasgow, won the Disco Derby this year. So she's online. If she's facing Gene Money in the future, that's going to be cracking as well. She's had great matches in Fair City with Ronan this year, and I think her match with Taylor Bryden was this year as well, which was amazing. Same as Zach Dynamite. Zach Dynamite, he won the Tri-Counties title, won the FCW tag titles, and yeah, he's putting in high quality matches whatever. And Caleb as well. We love Caleb. Big sexy Caleb. Tri-Counties champion, Regal Rumble winner, main event of Abney Anarchy. And I think he won the FCW title this year as well. And the Skull Brawl series is incredible on the interweb.
Yes. I love it.
That's his biggest achievement, is he's learning to skate. That is the He found out
about light switches this year, and I think that's a big thing to work out. The little light in the fridge scared him at first, but I'm glad that he's been able to recover from it. It's hard. I mean, there'll definitely be people out with that you'll think of as well. I mean, I'll mention Aspen anyway because you know, of course, I'm gonna. He's had a pretty good year, but I think the other three we've mentioned, they've probably had a bit more of a prolific year around the country as well. And for the likes of, I think Thatcher Wright's had a pretty good year for CPW.
Do you know someone else actually see? I've only been a couple of them, right? So I've not got a lot to base off of. But see, when I've been going to the Iron Girder shows with Bailey, do you know someone who, like, the last time I saw them was like early on in their career, so I haven't saw like the middle period, but you know who utterly, like, I was like, whoa, this is completely different from the last time I saw them? Kez Evans. Like, Evans is like very consistent, put it this way, when you go to like the shows, again, I think the shows are really good, the Iron Girder shows, but like him and like BT Gunn and stuff, like their chemistry is very good, and they, you know when you can just feel like someone just feels like they're at a different level than someone else on the show? Not in a bad way, but like you're like, oh, you just know that they've kind of like got it. They're just really smooth with it all. Him, and the last time I saw him was more like really early when I used to go back to ICW and stuff, where it was a different point in his career. And I was like, whoa, like this is like a whole different person. So I'd have to give him a shout out, I suppose, as like an honourable mention.
Absolutely. So that's five options we've thrown out for people if they want to believe us what we're saying, but no, I think it's gonna be quite competitive this year now that we've merged the category together, and that's why I'm gonna do like a top 10, because I don't think it's very fair if I just go, oh, this is the one wrestler. At least I can give people a rundown of who's getting voted, because I don't want to be accused of bias if Aspen wins. I can at least show the workings.
I mean, you still will. Because the majority of this list will probably end up being WrestleZone folk. This is people getting a half a minute.
And if I don't like it, do you know what they can do? Fuck off.
Well, they can do, they can go to tmail.com/ScottResNet, and they can go buy a t-shirt that says arrive, rig pulls, leave. Or they can buy a t-shirt that says Aberdeen Wankerthon, if they so wish. So, pay me. So, Tag Team of the Year. So, last year was the Foundation of the Future. Zach Dynamite, Ryan Riley, Bruiser Brad Evans. Technically a trio, but people just put in Foundation in the Future, so I really had to kind of put all three in. Because Zach and Ryan are team regularly in Fair City as well, and then Bruiser Brad and Ryan are elsewhere for WrestleZone. I think there's only really three major contenders I can think of, and it's the three that Aspen put out very recently as the top three in the country, which was Foundation in the Future, Casino Brutal, and Fair City Saints.
Yeah, I agree. I wrote down that mine's is the Foundation lads, and again, it's going to sound like we're just being heavy biased. Promise, the rest of my list has other people in it. But again, when I watch them, I like what they've got. They've got like an interesting dynamic. To be fair, see when WrestleZone started having the Fair City boys in as well, the four of them have a really good dynamic together. Like their chemistry works really well, and they both bring out the best in each other. Because that's one of the problems. Like just my opinion, the Foundation boys, they were better than what they were getting put up against. So they could only do what they had. They were getting put up against teams which weren't at the same calibre as them. They were outshone them, and it was like you could only get what you could get with the other half. So having someone that could go at the pace they could go at, and everything, has just made them all seem better, really. But I've not saw a lot in the Casino boys. Like, again, seen them a lot more recently with the shows I've been going to. It's been promised that 3 times I saw them this year. And it was interesting because, again, I hadn't saw them. I hadn't heard a lot about them. And then I saw them, I was like, oh, there's something about them. And seeing they're starting to get a lot of sort of traction and things is quite, it's interesting to see. I'll be excited to see where they go next year.
Yeah. I like as well that the three teams are all kind of spread out across the country.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean? Like, they're all like based in different locations.
Yeah.
Which makes it quite exciting.
They've all got different styles as well, which I think is useful. Yeah. They're not all doing the same thing. Because that's a problem, especially with tag teams. A lot of the time you'll get the same thing over and over again with a different skin on it, do you know what I mean? So they've all got very different styles.
And I suppose for Accolade's basis, the young team, ICW Tag Team Champions, back half of the year, they faced Arcade Violence, but I don't think that's someone I put into this category this year, but certainly when we get to the one to watch tag team, that's probably Arcade Violence seems to be a team I quite like the look of. I'm trying to think who else are champions. Game On at Fair City as well. They were champions for most of the year. Who else has got tag team divisions? I think Outfit, would they? They really came to their own again back half of the year. So as an overall year, still say the Foundation probably in there. But Casino, like I was saying about like not being able to see a lot of wrestling down Central Belt because it doesn't go online. Casino Brutale has been one of those teams where I've been watching on social media going, I love these guys just because of the way they sell themselves. And then you get to see a couple of matches, but because if they came up to Community Pro, for example, they announced come back to Peterhead, and the first match they announced is Casino Brutale versus whoever, I'm probably going to get my ticket because I want to see Casino Brutale wrestle. So that's a mark of a team that you want, that's good because you want to see them wrestle.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
Yeah, anyone else? I think, I don't think, I'm trying to see who's won it in the past. 99, of course, they're no longer really about because Jack Morris is in Japan now. Glasgow Grindhouse won it in 2020. They haven't really wrestled a lot. I don't think some in Copenhagen Championship Wrestling, some in ICW.
Yeah.
Really,
there's a lot of, like, and like you said, I think with the Arcade Fighter, like, there's a lot of, like, good teams that are coming up. Like, if that makes sense, like, there's a lot of teams that are kind of tail end of the year starting to break through a wee bit. So if you're looking at, like, tag team of the year that's been consistent throughout the year, it's probably the teams we've mentioned. Like, there's obviously a lot of exciting things going into next year, like, obviously Connor and Ronan, in WrestleZone, you've got Aspen and Caleb and all that sort of stuff. Like, there's a lot of interesting things, like, where teams are just kind of flourishing a wee bit.
So next year, the list should probably be quite different, if you think about it. Like, the landscape will be different. There's a lot of people trying something new. I think people are just, like, after lockdown, people try a lot of new things, and then they kind of played it safe for a while again. And it seems to be the later half of this year, a lot of people are kind of just throwing something out, seeing if it works. And that's what's exciting. That's what you want to see, like, seeing something new. So, yeah, I think next year will be interesting.
Absolutely. So one of the harder categories that I was trying to figure out names for was International Talent of the Year, or formerly known as Import of the Year. And
I've got hands all right, down.
Cool.
Let me yours first, because mine is going to overshadow anyone you bring up.
Right. I really struggled because I was trying to remember who had really come over this year. Scotty Tawhati was who won it last year. He was at Disco earlier this year. Eric Young made a couple of appearances, I think. Callisto made an appearance for Bob Wrestling. But I suppose you could also probably, because they wrestled in Glasgow, you could probably pick someone from the Impact roster as well, if you so wished. Possibly the guys from the Death from Bleeding Gums, because a lot of the international guys are there. So for someone who's, I haven't seen a lot of international talent, there's probably a good list of people. So yeah, throw them out there. Who you got?
So mine is my good friend, Neil Diamond Cutter, right? Because I did not know much about this man, But after Bleeding Gums, I think he's a good friend. I love that man. He's so fun. Like, good wrestler and all that, especially in death matches, right? Mark's probably laughing at me right now. He's like, oh, of course. But he's such a nice man too. Not as scary as you think he would be. And he showed me his jacket with all these different patches and that on it. And of course, me being me and being gobby. I was like, tell me all about your patches. So he told me all these stories about all these different ones and all the ones that he had stapled to him and stuff as well, which was interesting. But he was my favourite. I think he was great. I don't, like, I'm going to say something controversial, I don't like Neil Diamond as in the singer. So I don't like Sweet Caroline. So even though he came out to that, it was a tune. It was all good, but it wasn't my... There's something else I'm going to get cancelled for now. But it was a tune, everyone was dancing to it, and I think that was just a nice vibe. So here's my choice.
Well, anyone you want to throw in as well? Other than Moose?
yeah, I love how Kayleigh is just someone she spoke to. I mean, like, not even like, I guess him was all right, but he was just a nice guy.
I'm a personality person.
I mean, the one I've probably seen that's not Neil Diamond Cutter would be Eric Young. Obviously saw him on the Impact Tour and then saw him at Community Pro the other week. He really, really good. Seems to have a lot of time for people and was generally nice in my interactions with him. So like he'll easily be one there. But I think I wouldn't be surprised to see him come back. Like, do you know what I mean? Like, he seems like the type of guy that would but you gotta come back.
It's one of those, I don't know whether, I think he probably may have count as an international talent now, but Joe Hendry maybe as well, because he only really appears at Disco and Community Pro. Surprise Joe Hendry on Community
it's the
Pro.
Best type of Joe Hendry. Surprise Joe Hendry.
I loved it. I saw the clip of the big strong man. He literally said his name and Joe appeared, which is, oh man, as just a general gimmick goes, that's the best. I blew my mind if I was sitting in the crowd and you said Joe Hendry and Joe appeared. As an Impact talent now, I probably would count as an international talent if folk wanted to vote for him.
Technically, I think you're onto something. Technically, is because right, isn't he? He's not here all the time.
And technically, right is the best kind of right.
Exactly.
I still think my good friend Neil, though he's up there.
Because I was just looking, 2021, Big Dable one, and that was just like, I think it was year of his release, or just after his release.
He's a good shout, because he lives in America, and it feels like he's here every week.
Yeah.
So, did he do much British stuff, like Scottish stuff this year?
I don't think he did a lot of Scottish, it was more down south, wasn't it?
Like, he's done OTT and all that, but yeah, I've not...
Yeah.
No.
He was on Progress the other week.
Did he do a couple ICW matches, maybe? Was that with Andy at the start of the year? I don't know. It's been quite a long year. I'm trying to think who else would be. But no, I think who we've mentioned us probably as good as. Considering that the first international talent of the year was 2015 was Mick Foley, at least we're actually getting people that do wrestling that aren't just like stuttering out and doing a Mr. Socko and leaving, which is still amazing. But
I will say though, it's a good sign of the Scottish scene that we're struggling to pick names for like imports, because I feel like that was all that used to draw people to our show back in the day. But it's imports, so it's a good thing. Yeah.
Oh yeah, I mean, next year hopefully we'll get to see Elias on shows and stuff like that, and just get the I'd be happier if they just throw in some just wild import shows. Like, no, I Bop just got Callisto in for fucking no reason. I'd love just some more random shit like that. It's like, oh, who's coming to the show next week? Mind doing it. Rock and Wrestle had Ryback in the Mercury Hotel in Inverness. For
so random.
Well, Community Pro have got Santino Marella going to the government at the Fairfield Club next year, which will be insane.
Do you know what I was gutted at? Do you know who came here but no one got them to wrestle? My boy Gangrel. Love that man.
I know, the only time that we're so close is when ICW came up to Aberdeen and he was supposed to wrestle Jack Jester, I think it was.
Yeah.
Gangrel didn't make it, and I was gutted. Because that's the line of kind of wrestler I'm in to see. Like, Scott, you got your X-Pac, Gangrel, that's the level.
Maybe he just knew better and thought, yeah, those ICW Aberdeen shows, they're not going to go well, let's just leave them.
That was
also another.
There we go.
Yeah, wasn't it?
He was a nice man. Yeah.
So good. Apart from when he spat blood all over me, as I should have understood. I should have known he was going to do it, but I didn't think he was actually going to do it. And I was sitting in a white top covered in fake blood.
And to be fair, I think that show he's supposed to be on, that was Scotty Swift Iron Echo. So I mean, just might have left halfway through if you had to see that.
Yeah, that was something.
I've never seen it, to be fair. I've just heard other people's stories.
You never will, apparently.
Yeah, because it got cut, so it never went out. Because it was that bad. It's one of my favourite kind of things that I've seen a match that was so bad it got cut out of a broadcast. That's, there you go, there's a lol.
Because they've kept some utter shit on their shows.
It's like, that's like midway down on the Scottish wrestling iceberg. It's like somewhere in the middle, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah, move to the west, and that's the lower you get. Move of the year. I haven't written anything down, so that's not great.
You're not a moves guy. You know, you're a story guy. I get
exactly.
It.
Thank you, Kyle. You get me. You understand me. I'm there for the story. I'm not there for remembering what moves are. Darkest Lariat, Aspen won last year. Only ones I can think of off the top of my head are every time Judas does a Swanton Bomb.
That's like perfection. He does very well.
That's really it that I can think of, to be honest.
So the one I like, and I'm gonna be, I don't know what it's called, right? I'm no good with names because I never listen to commentary or anything. But you know the move that Sammy does where she like slides out the ring and like pulls him down? Love that.
The Shadowfax.
Love that. But no one else, like, it sounds bad. I can't, like, there's no other move that stands out that anyone else does. If I had to think of someone's individual move, there's only, like, that's the one person that stands out. Do you know what I mean? So,
Aspen's Chop Lariat, I don't know, one last year, but that's that class one. Moves, I don't really know, to be honest.
It's not necessarily, I couldn't say there's any, like, moves that stand out. There's, like, combinations, which I think are interesting, but there's no necessarily, like, any moves.
Mickey Vago's cartwheel elbow.
That's something. That's interesting.
It's a thing, yeah.
Isn't that the same move that Nicole Jasmine does? Do they know they have the same moveset?
I mean, my favourite part of that Mickey Vago one is not the move, it's that you can hear a tremendous roar, not from the crowd, but from behind the curtain when he does it.
Yeah.
That's always funny. But in terms of like just rant. The moves, not like finishers, because I was thinking more finishers, but like this is a very specific one, right? But when Bruiser Brad lariats Alex Webb, to be fair, Air Miles is really, like either one of them. To be
Air Miles was the Regal Rumble.
He lariats either of those.
That was Ryan, wasn't it? Ryan who got Air Miles at the Rumble and did the whole spinny flip thing.
Yeah, that one was disgusting as well. But yeah, what else have we got?
Aces High, Casino Brutale, it's pretty good. Speaking of Foundation, Peep Special, it's pretty decent as well. So there's a few things out there, but like you've pointed out, I'm more of a story guy. So if I've enjoyed the match, I've enjoyed the match. I don't really remember what the actual maneuvers are during the match. Kayleigh Valhalla's Hell Ride won in 2021. It's still pretty good when he's able to properly throw someone about with it. Move in general, Ronan stabbing someone in the eye with glass, I suppose that's a pretty
classic
move.
But no, that's about it. So this one's probably going to be one of the harder ones that I've got to muddle through the votes, because even though I put a note saying please give me the name of the move and the wrestler, nobody fucking reads that, and I usually just get a move or a wrestler, and then I've got to figure it out from there. So good luck to me in the future. Okay. Future Billy, watch the voting forms come in and go, fuck's sake, I don't know what the half of that is. Anyway, match of the year is next on here. So like I said, you guys have seen more matches this year, so you've probably got a better scope of things. What did I write down? Oh shit, what did I write down? I wrote down Kayleigh versus Connor at Station Hotel in January, Station Hotel Showdown, just because it was a match that was last minute, because it was supposed to be, Kayleigh versus Allen, maybe, and then it became Kayleigh versus Connor, and it was just tremendous. It was a great match for being unexpected. So yeah, that was the first one that came to my mind. Second one probably would be the Foundation from the Future versus Aspen, Kayleigh, and Johnny Lyons from 2010. Throw that one in there as well, just because of the absurdity of it. But yeah, that's the top two I think of top of my head.
I think that was my mum's favourite match. My mum went to one wrestling show with me, and that's what she saw. And honestly, that was the best thing that she'd ever saw. She kept talking about it. She loved it. She ended up going and buying one of Aspen's tops after it, because she was just obsessed with it. No, see, when I was thinking, it was very obvious to me what my favourite match was, because I physically like twisted about it, being like, I've not saw a match better than this. It was, remember, Zach and Kayleigh? I forgot what show it was.
Was that Nations?
Yeah, it was they two, and it was, I don't know, there was just something about it. It just felt like a perfect match. The intensity, the story, everything. And they two, I didn't really know how they would, I don't know what it was going to be like, them two really wrestling together. They're very different styles. Zach's kind of like brute, writing about it, very intense, very hard hitting and all that, whereas Kayleigh's a lot more of the sort of like monster aspect of it, like getting in, and I don't know, I'm not really finding the right words, I'm butchering this.
And to mention Zach as well, I'll throw Zach versus Yuji Maki from Ardler Mania as well, because it was the opening match of the show and it was phenomenal. It was the best match on the show, which, I mean, when you think you've got Emerson Jane on that show as well, and you've got Kayleigh as well in that big multi-man match, the first match on, Maki and Dynamite just stole it straight away. Had little Tom Atlas come out dressed as Maki, and at one point he got thrown to the back and he just audibly went "Ah!" and it was fucking hilarious. It was just amazing to hear him, just to hear it right slide past as well. But yeah, that was really good as well. But it seems to be common denominator between the three is like Kayleigh, Dynamite, who we mentioned earlier, like as wrestler of the year. So
yeah, and it makes sense. If they're saying wrestler of the year, then match of the year would coincide with that. And again, as I've already said, to repeat myself, like every match that I saw Zach be part of was good. I never at all once this year went, that was an all right match or whatever. Like, I always had some sort of emotion and some sort of feeling behind it. Like, I really liked it, or I was like, what on earth is going on? Like, I left every match thinking about it. And that match, honestly, is one of my favourites I think I've ever saw in person. I've got a small handful of matches that I saw in person that I really, really liked, and that's up there. It's like, if it's not one, it's very close to it. I think that says a lot. What about you?
Yeah, that one's probably up there, to be honest. I think I've got a couple of notable mentions, but I don't know if these are recency bias, but I'll throw them out there anyway. So from the Bleeding Gum show, there was a match between Jack Harrop and Alton Thorne.
Which
was brilliant, to be honest. It was, I think with death matches, sometimes you can fall into the habit of just smashing things over people's heads, and that's pretty much it. In the same way that you see when you get like your cruiserweight matches and people just flipping all that, right? There's no like story to it. You get a lot with death matches, but this one, there's a lot of story behind it. Like, they actually built to all the big stuff in the match and all that. Spoiler for if you're watching the show on IWTV when it comes out, the match ended in no contest is the word I was looking for, because they both came off the apron through a spiderweb of barbed wire. So that's how the match ended. But yeah, overall, really, really good match. In terms of, you know, normal wrestling, it doesn't get everyone's knickers in a twist. Community Pro from the past weekend, the Ravy Davey against Thatcher Wright for the title. Match was good, but purely for the reaction to the finish, like Ravy Davey, where's the cat? Ravy Davey winning the title in Govan against a Tory might be one of the greatest things I've ever witnessed. Like, kids were jumping, like kids started running around the venue, like screaming, like things were getting thrown. Like next thing you know, there's like 40 kids in the ring celebrating with them. All that. Brilliant.
Like the end of is it Unforgiven 2001 with Kurt Angle on everyone's shoulders kind of thing.
Oh.
I was looking through the last year of matches, like they'd be voted for our match of the month, and yep, Dynamite Riley versus Fair City Saints for Fair City Wrestling. Regal Rumble, the match itself was in there. The Foundation from the Future versus Caleb Aspen Johnny, yep. Aspen versus Caleb Abgaraki. Emerson J versus Zach Dynamite, FCW, a couple more FCW matches, Motor City Machine Guns against Josh Alexander and Eric Young, Steg versus Lost Boy Aspen from Community Pro, which I've heard nothing but good things about, just because it was wildly different to what people were probably coming in to see, thinking it was going to be just a fun wee fight with inflatable hammers, and from what I hear, it was not that at all.
Nope. Yeah, that was a really good match. If we're talking matches that I have seen in Scotland, Charlotte versus Io Sky from the house show in Glasgow is one of the best matches I have ever seen live. And I've been to the, you know, fucking Money in the Bank and all that stuff. Like, I've seen the big shows. That's one of the best shows matches I've seen in person.
So good. Like, me and Kyle put this way, it was just a house show. Normally, it's just mid, like, I mean, whatever.
It was a house show match for a title. So you already knew what the finish was going to be. You know who was winning.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And even then, we were on the edge of our seat. Mm-hmm. We were like, there was false finish. Like, me and Kyle were actively like, what's going on? And yeah, I've never saw a match like this. If it was a WrestleMania match, you'd be like, that could contend as match of the night. I don't know why they decided to have one of the best matches of their career in the Hydro in Glasgow when it wasn't being taped. But fair play. It was class.
That's the thing with Charlotte, though. She's absolute death as a character. Like, give her a microphone and you hate her, and you should, even if you do or don't, but when you ring the bell, she consistently puts the best match on, and it's ridiculous. Like, it just doesn't gel on TV, but the actual in-ring product is phenomenal.
So good. And she was really class, actually. She got in trouble because she spent too long, like, trying to meet like people all around the ring and all that and stuff, which was also the same day that I met my husband, Pete Dunne.
Of course.
Yeah, like that.
Of course, Butch was out and about.
What a man.
Well, you've noticed we've not mentioned whatever they're called, Butch and Ridge Holland, again, with Drew against Bobby Lashley and the Street Profits.
I only saw one person that match. My eyes were glued to Pete Dunne. Love that man.
It was my piss break, to be fair. So.
Shit, no, what's up?
Oh.
He wouldn't let me be alone.
No, I went, Drew's in the ring. The queue for the toilets just now is going to be nil. How much I go?
See, it's a fair difference to the last time I went to WWE house show, which was when last time they were in the AECC, I think. And it was my piss break was the Usos against Hype Bros.
That's fair.
Yeah,
but, I mean, now Usos are like the boys.
And so's Matt Cardona as well. He's one of the most, like, one of the biggest wrestlers in independent wrestling. And there's Mojo Rawley, who's shite then, to be honest. But less said about that, the better. So I'm acting like he was like part of speaking out. I don't think he was, but I don't know.
It's not pretty good.
I don't know. He just wasn't good at it. I'm doing terribly at muting myself coughing here, so I apologize to the listeners for that. There we go. Right, feud of the year. This is another one where I started thinking about it, going, I don't remember any feuds outside of the Northeast this year. So, outside of that, possibly Thatcher, Ravy Davy. That's probably a fairly strong contender. Up here, we've got Ronan Damien. Got the Saints versus Foundation. The Foundation versus Outfit seems to be, it's been ticking along quite nicely the back half of the year. Else, I mean, I don't think Mr. Wrestle Omar Muhammad against Dawkins and Tucker is going to be getting many votes. It might, you know, you never know. Mr. Wrestle might be working hard and getting several emails together. But yeah, so I suppose I have all that I'd probably go Damien versus Ronan because we've got to see a blindfold match and someone stabbed. So, what's that like?
I think it made sense. That was, again, that was one of the only blindfold matches where I was utterly entertained because it's the same thing. You know, there's certain matches where you always see the same thing that happens. Every blindfold match has the same bits in it. And theirs was good. They were kind of like thought outside the box a wee bit. They utilised it to their advantage because I'm not going to lie, see, I saw the blindfold match. I was like, oh, here we go. I bet I could call what's going to happen here. And no, it was really entertaining. So I think, again, that one, a bit biased, saw it. So I actually went through the whole emotions of it. It was nice to see something different. Again, seeing a stabbing in WrestleZone, didn't expect it. Loved it. That makes me psychotic. Be a bit different. Off at it. But apart from that, I was trying to think, because when it came to feuds, I couldn't actually think of many that was, like, proper feuds going on. The only other one, was it this year that had the whole Martina Dream Money thing in Discovery? Or was that more the end of last year?
I think
that was this year.
Was that tag? So I think that was probably more last year into this year because they had that because they were having this False Count Anywhere match that's appeared everywhere, hasn't it? And then appeared a little bit towards the end of this year, start of this year with was it this year's tag or was last year's tag? When they became tag champions, it was Gina Martina was supposed to be in the match, then Emerson replaced. So I think it was last year, but I don't know.
Yeah.
To be honest, I'm rambling now. I'm not sure.
We were at that show, weren't we?
Yeah, because I was trying to think.
Current exchange.
When did we? No, but when was the first disco show we went to? Was that last year or the first disco show? It was the first disco show we went to. Remember, there was also Haskins versus Aspen. That had good momentum, and then just kind of stopped. Might be reasons for it. I don't know, but I think that was last year that happened because that was a good feud. But again, it's not this year, so it doesn't matter. But yeah, when I was looking at feuds, I think WrestleZone had the only ones I can really remember because I was trying to think of other shows I'd been to. And again, it could just be the whole of I didn't go to a lot of shows at the time or there was something really ongoing. The only feud, for example, the last show that I went to was Casey versus Hera. And that was it. It was an actual feud. But yeah, I think I would have to say Damien and Ronan was interesting. It gave Ronan something different to like work towards since he was quite new. Gave him something to do. And then Damien, it was nice to see a different side of him because since I'd been going to shows, I'd only ever saw him really as a champ. So you see like a different side of him was interesting for me, I suppose.
Yeah.
I think one that kind of got the legs cut out of under it because of just unfortunate things happened during it. I think Archer Vago could have been something special.
Yeah.
But because of I think Archer got COVID during it, and so it just kind of ground to halt, and it started back up for the mosh pit match at Anarchy, and then it really kind of fizzled out from that point onwards. I think they had the makings of a good feud, but didn't really. Mm-hmm. Get the good feud because it started off hot with the turn in January at Station Hotel, and then they just kind of petered away, and we got Main Event Vago for three shows, which
it was a shame because really like there could have been more to it. It could have gave them both a bit more depth to try something new, and they just let it go, which just seems to be a bit of a running theme with a lot of places just now. They just kind of let things go.
Yeah, I mean, so it seems like a lot of companies are just going for one-shot events. So, like we're saying, trying to think of feuds, but a lot of places are just going, this is the match, this is the card here, cool, next month, another place, this is the card here. There's no kind of interlinking pattern of stuff. I mean, you get that a little bit with Disco, but they only run like 5 shows a year. So you can't really get a proper thing going with it. Because I think Judas and Ian have been starting something for the last 3 shows. But hasn't really went anywhere with it just yet. Wrestle are there once a month, once every couple of months, so they've got that kind of through line to have a feud and to keep the stories going. And they use their core roster most of the time as well, so they're pretty much guaranteed to have them at each show, barring illness. So that's probably why they get the votes most of the time. They won last year with Dynamite, Damien, and Faith and Aspen over the title, which was great, which was a phenomenal year for all three, so that's probably why they get the votes. So yeah, that's probably it.
I think so, but do you know what I would say? I think they've kind of dropped the ball with that though. Not just them, everyone, as you're saying, too many people are booking for the show and not long term, which though everyone's going to fizzle out fast because it's all good having a couple of good matches and stuff, whatever, right? But if you've got no investment in it, you're not going to want to go. Because take other shows, see if it's just like a couple of good matches, right? Might go, might not. But see if you're actually invested in something, you actually care about it, you'll push yourself to go. You'll change your plans to want to turn up. You'll go out your way to make sure to see it. And that's where you get someone long-term invested. And I want to go, I want to see the payoff for this. I want to have that emotion. Like, you can watch good matches all day, but see if I'm not feeling anything behind it. It's just another good match. I probably won't remember anything about it. I think that's one of the issues, I would say. Like, again, maybe I've just not been going to the right shows or seeing the right things, but the later half of the year, we went on to feuds. There's no feuds. There's very little storylines, or there's storylines that are either one-dimensional or you're like, oh, that's just for one show. So I don't care. Like, I think there needs to be a wee bit more of a investment in people, let people do their own thing. And I don't know what it is. It just seems to be a lot of just another random match.
I think some companies like your Fair City and your Pro 2, they probably do a little bit more story wise because they try to put out bi-weekly or bi-monthly content. But it's just trying to follow it, I suppose, a little bit here and there. Because I think they had some stuff with the junior heavyweight title. They had Ian Ambrose, Dicky Divers stuff going on. So they might be underrated. I'm sure we get plenty of votes for Fair City because once the vote opens, the Fair City fans are fairly loyal. They'll throw in their two pence worth. Maybe it's just what I've missed, a proper amazing feud that's happened in there. But I think our half year award winner was from Fair City. I think it was Ian Ambrose, Dicky Divers, like I just mentioned. And they had apparently some wild brawls. They had a ladder match as well with the title and stuff. So yeah, maybe we're not going to the night shows. That's possibly it. And we'll see the votes come in and we'll go, oh yeah, that happened at whatever this year.
Yeah.
So, Kyle, did you throw in any? However, I think you've been quite quiet.
Yeah, I can't really think of any, to be honest. Like, I mean, Damien and Ronan's probably the one. With feuds, like, and again, it's probably just a case of not paying attention to enough of them. More than anything, I'm sure there's things happening. But I guess a lot of companies obviously do like it on the show. So like show to show, they'll have like things that like change that they progress the story and stuff. So if you're not at the show and there's no way to watch online, or you can't, or you're not keeping up online or whatever, you're not going to see it. So I guess that could be a thing. Mm-hmm. But yeah, if I had to pick one, it would be Ronan and Damien with the whole stabby eye thing.
Mm-hmm. Well, like you say, for storyline speaking, you get a ticket. When like the whole Army Arnica card came out and that match was announced, like Kelly's usually just like, she'll take the event as it comes. So she might come to one, she might not, but it's really down to what's on the show. And when we're going through the card for Army Arnica, she was like, yeah, I want to go. Because, well, one, Caleb won the Regal Rumble, so she wanted a ticket anyway. But when she heard that match was on it, she was like, yeah, I need to see Damien versus Ronan. And then I had to explain to her what a blindfold match was, and she went, that's a stupid thing. And she was just shouting along and loving it. She's my gauge if a wrestling match is good, because she only goes to see it live. So if she likes it, then it's done what it needs to do. It's pulled the emotion it needs to. I've watched wrestling that long, I'm jaded, and I just want to see someone do something silly. And that's why Captain Allen is one of my favorite wrestlers, because he does very little. But what he does is amazing at the same time. Show of the year. So I mentioned earlier Regal Rumble, WrestleZone, which is the one that keeps coming back into my mind. So it's the one that I keep thinking, oh, must think of another one. I liked Army Anarchy. I think if I broke it down, I probably enjoyed that show more. But the Regal Rumble just kind of tickled me the right way with the Silver Rumble anyway. Caleb won it. We got some silly bollocks with Mr. WrestleZone in it. Some silliness with Tucker Dawkins and Dynamite against, I think it was Aspen, Caleb and Omar, I think maybe it was. So we got some shenanigans across the board and a good feel good ending. So I'm putting Regal Rumble forward. But there's been, like I said, I've been to 10 shows this year, so I don't have a lot to really work from.
Well, do you want to go for advocate speaking first? I have two shows that come to mind, but I'll let you go first before I say mine.
Yeah, so there's a few. I think again, recency, that community pro show the second night with Ravey Thatcher for the title, Steg Aspen, Street Fight, the ladder match, women's title. Like there was so much on that show. That was really good. Surprise Joe Henry, of course. That show really, really, really strong. And it was a good mix of like just fun matches and then like extreme stuff, obviously, like the ladders and all that, and the street fight, and then obviously the story stuff was like the whole Thatcher and Davey thing. So you've got that. Obviously, Bleeding Gums for me is up there, but again, that's a very niche thing, so I understand. If you're not a deathmatch wrestling fan, that's probably not on your list. But for a deathmatch show, it was really, really, really good. And I said this kind of when I was talking about the match with Alton Thorne and Jack Harrop. Every match was different, which again, in the deathmatch scene, you don't see a lot of. It's just like tubes, everything. Whereas every match had a different thing, and like everything was quite unique, which I know Andrew kind of spoke about on here. That was his plan, and it came through, which was nice. So there was that, and then if we're going back, I think that disco show, the Excellent Adventure one, was probably the most fun show of the year. It was another good mix of like fun matches, like obviously like exciting stuff, like fun stuff. And then you had your big thing at the end, obviously, with Gene running the title. So it was like one of those shows that was just a mixed bag of just goodness. So, yeah, I think that's probably a three for me that would be up there.
Well, you've kind of taken my two, but in a nice way, because I was going to say my two are the disco show, the Excellent Adventure, because, as you said, it had a bit of everything. It was so strange, but in the best way. No one, it was like one of those shows, you know, just didn't take itself seriously, and that's what made it fun. It was just like, it was just such a fun show to go at. Again, a bit embarrassed for me because I took my mum to that show. My mum's not been to a wrestling show since like 2004, where we went to like a SmackDown house show, right? My mum used to love wrestling, hadn't been in years because Kyle was like at that show. I took her. And she turned around, she was like, this is so much fun. Like, she was invested again, as you were saying with Kayleigh. The fact that my mum was so invested in people and situations that she had no idea what was going on. She just knew them as people, this person's pretty all right, whatever and stuff. And she left it being like, this is exactly what I needed just now. And the second one is actually the Bleeding Gums as well. And that's where I'm a bit different from Kyle. I'll watch it, if a deathmatch shows on, I'll watch it. But one of my biggest things is, I'm not as invested in it as like Mark and Kyle and stuff, because something I don't like death matches for the sake of death matches. I don't like people just hurting themselves, but there's no story to it, right? I'm one of those guys, like, I get it, I appreciate it, I understand the work and all that that goes into it. It's a niche, it's not always for me, but see when it's just, here's a weapon for the sake of a weapon, I don't like that, it's no for me, I can't sit down and watch that. Whereas this show, there was a combination, not everything was a death match, which I thought gave something for everyone. And then there was a different type of death match for everyone. Every, like, theme, we'll call it a theme or sort of thing, like, it was for a reason. Like, everyone had it. It suited the people that were in the match. It really showcased their strengths. There was a reason behind it. And for me, someone who can take or leave one of those shows, if I liked it, I'm using me as a benchmark. It was actually, it had something for everyone. That's why I'm excited for the next one, and I never thought I'd see the day where I was buzzing for deathmatch wrestling. So I have to, like, biased or no biased, I have to put them two up there.
Go back through what we've had this year. So Fair City got a couple of show of the month awards. Regal Rumble, Disco's Excellent Adventure, Avenue Anarchy, Disco's debuted Livingston got one. ICW Shug's House Party 8 got a vote. Impact's UK Invasion in Glasgow. Bleeding Gums won the November show of the month, and Fife Pro Wrestling as well, or now Power Pro. They got September's. So there's been a good mix of winners this year for the show of the month. So that's again just further kind of cements that shows are consistently good in Scotland at the moment. Where it means we, between the three of us, we mentioned about three. At least three to four shows that that we've enjoyed attending. So just makes it nice and difficult for people to vote, which is always good, always interesting, because it's the worst than seeing 100 votes come in and it's 99 for one thing and then one for something else. Right, so that's where are we up to? Promotion of the year. So a new category that we've got this year is poster of the year, show poster, because I see some great posters, and it was kind of jumped off with Power Pro putting out there Twas the Night Before Christmas 2. Twas the Night Before Wrestling 2, with the Home Alone kind of theme, which I think is what they used last year as well, but just different people on it. But even with that being said, it's probably Discovery Wrestling's Excellent Adventure, though, isn't it? For best 100%. Yeah.
There's no other one. See, when I saw that, I was like, no way. And see the video that went off the back of it as well. I was shit on Instagram being like, this is the best thing I've ever seen in my life. Mm-hmm. This is so good. It made me want to go and rewatch the movies as well.
Yeah. So this might be a category that I only put out once. I think I put Ring Announcer of the Year out a few years back, and just everyone voted for Simon Cassidy. So I think this might be a one and done year, but I'll see what comes through. But nothing.
Sorry, I'm passing my pizza.
But yeah, nothing really I can think of comes close to that Excellent Adventure poster. So
yeah,
I'll be interested to see what other votes come in. Unless Kyle, you're thinking of one.
No. I mean, most have been consistently good. There's not been as much writers. As there are probably, because a lot of people have realised that Bear Hug's probably the best place to get your posters, instead of just having random guys do it. But a spade's a spade, Kayleigh, right? If the man makes a good poster, he makes a good poster. I will say next year though might be interesting with ICW moving to like a standalone show sort of thing rather than having Fight Club tapings. You could actually get some interesting posters there, because I remember back in the day,
you used to have some good ones.
They used to have fun ones when they were doing that sort of thing. So you never know. I think a lot of companies now just do the standard, don't they? Here's the people that are on the show, here's the name, here's what it is. So that's why the Excellent Adventure one was probably a standout, because it was a bit unique.
I mean, a show poster I sent you recently, though, I mean, like I said, there has been some shiters, but the one I've seen recently that looked like it was, I mean, I like I said to you, I understood the reference to it. I absolutely understood the reference to it. But when you look at it, it looks like a terrorist event. And it's not a good post. It's not in this day and age. What? You can't put that poster out.
Nah, show me this later.
Yeah. Nah, it's not good.
It's, yeah. Like, if you see the poster that it's referenced to, yes,
yeah,
it looks like it. But it does also look like a terrorist event. So, yeah, that'll be for your fun to see later. So, yeah, I don't think there's much I could really add to the poster of the year, because, yeah, it's probably going to be a one and done. But I think the ones that Power Pro or Fife Pro have been putting out pretty good ones this year as well, for their few shows they've done, but Bear Hug's pretty shit hot with their postering, even if it's just the standard pile of guys in the middle, here's the logo kind of thing. They're still pretty good to look at, that you want to kind of get it and just put it on your wall or something like that, or what have you. So yeah, so before we go into like future stuff, like ones to watch and all that, we have podcast of the year. Now, as someone who is had to be part of all of them, I probably have got a bit more of a scope on which ones I actually liked. I liked most of them. I liked all of them this year, I think. There were some duffers. I won't be naming who, but there was a few shite ones this year. But for myself, I'm going to throw in Ian Skinner, we were due to talk about Goldmember, and I did not watch the film again, and I thought we were just dick about for an hour or so, but he came with notes, and we really got in depth about Goldmember. So that's up there for me. Same with Alex Webb. I only really want to record for about an hour, even though that we've been out for about an hour and a half, about Guardians of the Galaxy. And I think we talked about the first two for 2 hours. We really only really tagged on the third film at the end. Grado, because I got Grado.
Yes.
Not really much more than that, even though it was a shite of an episode because Jack was having a dick of a night and Grado just went, I'm free now. I was like, oh no. So I'd leave Kelly with Jack crying. But yeah, I'm going to go speak to Grado. So, bye. So that was a panic, 45 minutes of my life. Scottish Hottie, again, because I got Scottish Hottie on the show, and he was really nice. Yes, so put that in there. And Casino Brutale, because again, they were really nice, and they were just a good laugh to have on the show. So it's been a fairly strong couple seasons this year, 5 and 6. All things considered, when I was trying to end the year thinking, I'm going to do it again. I think I'm done now, because I'm now a grown up and I've got a child. But I've got Ravy Davy this year as well. So yeah, it's been pretty good. Mike Bondo. Me, did okay. Oh, and Halloween Hijinks, the quiz. I'll throw that one in there as well.
I did care about that quiz. I tried to play along and I did not score very well.
But we all learned something really important in that Judas looks like a fan of Twilight.
Really does, doesn't he?
I've never saw Twilight.
Neither have I, but that his reaction to that is the funniest thing that's probably happened this year.
I've never read the books either.
That's it. It's like, but if you look at him though, you wouldn't be surprised, you know? Yeah, you probably like vampires and shit, don't you? Which is probably why
he looks tired.
Which is probably why he gave me a little bit of extra sauce when he threw his fucking jumper in my face at Christmas Chaos.
Oh, do you have a fun fact? See at Community Pro the second night, he obviously threw his jumper into the out of the ring before the ladder match, and someone just assumed they could take it home with them. And apparently we walked past him and went, oh, thanks. And then he was like, oh, wait a minute. So yeah, you almost didn't even get that jumper thrown at you, because it almost was just somewhere in Glasgow.
Of course, someone tried to take it.
Because I was about to say the same, even though I'm up in the northeast, and like, of course, had to.
I'm allowed to say it.
otherwise, the day of birth bonanza, it's always a fucking riot, because that one broke down very quickly, where we started off really well, because it was like 27 degrees, we all got all really hot and annoyed at each other for being there. So I think I told Alex Webb to fuck off at one point, you know, big time YouTuber, Alex Webb, tell him to fuck off was good fun. We had Moose on this year as well, for anyone who's trying to think of other ones. Joey Legend.
Best one though. Like, your best podcast of the year, hands down, was Fraser Garvin.
That was a good episode. I'll give, yes, absolutely. That was a great episode.
Like, my favorite part of all that was, like, well, actually, I've got a specific favorite part that I'll clear up in a minute. But my favorite part was just, you mentioned the roller coaster thing, like, just completely, like, as if it was normal, right? But obviously, we've known for a while, so like, that's just a normal statement. But obviously, you didn't know this, so you're just like, wait, what the fuck? You were in a roller coaster crash.
Well, that was like the first time you told me, and I went, sorry, what, a roller coaster crash? And he was like, yeah. And then this is a part where my brain wants to ask questions it probably shouldn't. So I was like, Kayleigh, don't ask about all these things, because the poor man may have PTSD, but he's all right about it. He answered them.
That was a wild Google.
My favourite part of that episode was when he told the story about Terry Garvin and the being the king of catch, because he was a fisherman and all that, which none of that's true. And that was the, like, I was sitting on the couch pissing myself laughing, because I'm sitting there going, his dad's not a fisherman, what is he talking about? And he's like, oh yeah, aye, well, that's a fisherman and that stuff, and that's where they got the name for king of catch and all that stuff. And I'm like, that's not true either, because it was Aspen that was the king of catch. And that was, oh, it was a whole thing. I was that made me laugh. That genuinely tickled me.
That was a great episode. Just because it's one of those why everyone, every time I put out a list going, or our question going, who do you want on? Fraser was always mentioned. I was like, he's only had like 5 matches. Why would I don't want to speak to him at this point? Give him a little bit more. And then that weekend he won the junior heavyweight title, or the X title, whatever the fuck it's called, the belt. So I was like, perfect, excellent timing. And then we got the roller coaster story, which was top 10 stories of the year. We had Andrew with the gums as well. That's a great video episode to watch, just to watch me squirm. That's a good one. Of the on location stuff, the 90 seconds I had Ronan King, where he immediately called wrestling fans cunts. That's probably, I wouldn't say it's a contender to win, but it's certainly an episode. It's certainly a thing that happened during the year. But it was
great. Do you know what we spoke about? Because we did mention earlier, was the Aspen and Caleb build up to the Anarchy match, where you did an ad read about your balls while they just sat there and were like, what the fuck?
And they asked a lot of questions about them.
That was my favourite part. They started asking, like, oh, so what does that do?
I learned too much about that episode.
Well, the episode before that was Scotty Swift, and that's when I got the sponsorship, and I opened the gambit with Dad with, how are your balls, Scotty? So, you know, I'm not saying that the sponsors are knocking down my door, but I don't think they will if they hear how I do the ad reads. That's why I now just do for the audio version. I do like a 20-second bit at the start of the episode, so it's only on the audio versions now.
But controversially, I'm a Jim Cornette guy, right? Which is ironic considering how much I love death matches. But on his podcast, his ad reads are so bad that, like, they're entertaining, and people actually listen to them instead of skipping over them. So maybe you're onto something. If people are like, what the fuck's this? Can I have a laugh with it?
Controversial. You know, makes cash. I'm going to get a drink quickly. 2 seconds.
Enjoy that.
But especially, like, Ian brings a different vibe for the ad reads because he does the research, and it terrifies me because then he starts asking me loads of questions. Yeah. Like we have dealt with this evening. He asks loads of questions about it and tries to pump up the ad, and I'm just like, I don't know. I've just got the information in front of me. That's all I've got. SWN20, manscaped.com, 20% off.
If you enjoy it, like, you do what you have to do. Do you know what I mean? Respect you.
I mean, it works.
This year for you.
To be honest, I don't really use this for what it's meant to. I use it to shave my head because I'm a bald man and it's very quite thin up here, so it's quite easy just to...
Can you use your balls to my head?
If it's good for your balls, it's good for your head.
I suppose.
It's for sensitive skin, and it all works. So yeah, fantastic. It was free, so get 20% off if you go to manscaped.com. Anywho, it's on my desk. That really shouldn't be there.
Conversation.
I know, far too much.
Sorry, there's another cat trying to get in my pizza.
They are our cats. Like, I realize Kayleigh said that as if, like, a random cat. Another cat's just showed up.
We've left the door open.
Sebastian has made... Yeah, Sebastian's came in, like, 3 times this matter with her tail, and Captain's just confused that we're sitting here. He's like, what he's doing? So he'll probably come over at some point.
Yeah, no, I've probably got Sandy outside my door here, just like, looking at the door going, you should be in bed. What's after 9 o'clock? You should be in bed. Why are you here? So we're on to the one-to-watches. So much like the Wrestler of the Year, I'm merging the one-to-watch male and one-to-watch female category into one. Again, doing a top 10 of who's getting voted for. Oh, we haven't done Promotion of the Year. We'll go to Promotion of the Year, and then we'll do one to watch. Promotion of the Year. So last few years, it was WrestleZone last year, which, of course, Aubrey Wagathon bias. That's why it won. No other reason other than putting on consistent shows. They do that the whole year. Past winners have been Discovery Wrestling, ICW, Discovery Wrestling, ICW. So... probably WrestleZone or Community Pro would probably put as my two, maybe Fair City as well, because they seem to be put on consistent shows in general. So that'd be my top three I'd throw out there.
I love that you picked three out of the four promotions that you've seen this year.
Sorry, WPL.
One's just left out. I mean, it's a tough one, because, you know, From a pal perspective, you know, I'll shout out Bleeding Gums, but they've done one show. So, I mean, WrestleZone have been consistent again. Personally, for me, I felt like, I feel bad, I missed the last couple of shows, so, like, I can't really give an opinion on how the year ended. But I feel like it was the classic, like Anarchy was good, and then we sort of just mellowed out a wee bit, and obviously there's a ramp up to like the Rumble. So, but overall, I think it was a good year. The CPW shows that I've been to have all been really good. I've not seen them have a bad show. Because we obviously saw them did the show in Mount Vernon where we got Ronan and Connor tag teaming for the first time with their lap dancing gimmick.
Yeah, they lap danced on me. What a time of their life.
I'm trying to think. The Iron Girder shows have been really good. Mm-hmm. Like, it's been quite consistent, to be honest. I think across the board, everything I've seen has been mostly positive. Disco shows have been good. But again, I think Disco haven't really blown me away particularly with shows, apart from that excellent adventure show, and they don't really put on a lot of shows, so it's hard to be like, Joey, no, don't lick the garlic and herb.
Well,
I know
that's
it's
the
good.
Thing. See, when you're saying that, Disco's always, this is like to their detriment, I suppose. Disco's always at a consistent level, where, like I said earlier on, because everything's at a consistent level, it doesn't always stand out because that it's gave itself its caliber. Does that make sense? Like, whereas if a show has peaks and troughs, when it has a better show than the last one, you really think about it being like it's better. Whereas any Disco show I've been to, I've really enjoyed it start to finish. It's had about everything, and it's been its own lane. Disco is very different from the other ones, I suppose. WrestleZone, again, same as what Kyle said. Always enjoy it for so many reasons. It's been really good. Again, didn't go to the last two shows, so I can only comment from what I saw online. But the only thing I would say from what I saw online, I don't know, just there's a wee something was missing. It might have been because I wasn't there, but I feel like there's just something like, no, but what I mean is like, for a while there was just a spark and something really like drawn me in, and I felt like there was nothing, there was no matches beforehand that I was like, that's a match I really want to see, that was a match I'm going to see, rather than a match I want to see. And I feel like for so many shows, there was at least one standout match that I couldn't wait to see. And for the two we couldn't go to, maybe because I wasn't going, I didn't think about it so deeply, but there was no match that I thought, oh, I really can't wait to see that. I was like, oh, it's, I'm missing it, I'm gutted, but all right, okay. And then going on to, again, Iron Girders. Like, Community Pro has been good. I've only been a few of them, really enjoyed what I saw. And then Iron Girders, maybe I've got a soft spot only because it's like the first shows my little sister that I've been to. Never been to wrestling shows with my sister before. And the fact that I see her being younger and really liking it and kind of seeing like a lot of me when I was younger. And I wish that I had someone that would do that with me. So I think, see, when I see her get invested, like she was sitting at her first show, oh my God, what's going on? And she was like on the edge of her seat. And that's someone who didn't like wrestling before. And that show made her feel that way. So I kind of have a bit of a soft spot. They are good, but I feel like maybe I think they're better than what they are because I spend most of my time, it's going to sound heavy creepy, watching her watching the show because I just love seeing how she reacts. Like, so they make it everything feel a bit better. But I think all of them, I've not saw bad shows this year. Like,
I get that because, like I've said earlier, for watching matches, if Kelly enjoys it, I know that they've done the, I'm going to enjoy it anyway because I want to see wrestling. But if she's enjoying it, then I know that it's done what it needs to do because they've got someone who only sees a few shows a year and they watch it on telly. They don't do any of that kind of stuff. They just watch what they see. And it shows that. You mentioned Iron Girders. They won our One to Watch promotion last year. And it sounds like every show you see or hear about, they just seem to put on good shows. So it's another one that's probably consistent each year, each show as well. So. Yeah, another bulge out. So, but like you said, I haven't really heard many bad shows. The ones that I cover anyway for the website. So, it's been a fairly like you said, I don't think there's many shows really that's blown my mind. Going, oh, this is the greatest show I've ever seen ever. But they've always been good at the very least.
Yeah.
So maybe it's just because we're now 2 full years into the shows returning after the pandemic, so it's kind of settled a little bit. Like last year, we were just excited to see wrestling again, and now we're kind of being able to go to shows whenever we can afford to and all that kind of stuff. Maybe it's just a bit stagnated, but just kind of just settled down because we can go. There's no major like, oh, I need to wear a mask to go to the show kind of shit, which, I mean, sometimes it works for smelly people. But, anyway, right, Ones to Watch. So, yep, merging the categories last year, One to Watch male was Ronan King. And for one to watch female, it was Moxie Malone. Moxie went on to win the IGPW King of the Fling. At the time of recording, she's got a match at Fear and Loathing for the ICW Women's World title. So that was a pretty good, solid shout from the voters to put Moxie Malone as the winner for that. Ronan is fantastic. Hasn't really got the accolades and the titles to go with it, but whenever you see a Ronan King match, you know you're in for a good time somehow. So I'd probably put Ronan forward again. So I think 2024 is going to be a proper good year for him. But I'm also going to put Judas Gray forward as my other shout, because I think now he's properly getting out there. I mean, well, his debut was at Wrestle Carnival, so that's a pretty big deal in first place. But I think he's now kind of venturing out towards the back end of the year around Scotland and Disco and Community Pro and Wrestle Zone. So yeah, I think Judas is probably one that people should be keeping an eye on for 2024. Anyone else you can think of? Daisy Jenkins. I'll throw Daisy Jenkins as well, because I have a real soft spot for Daisy Jenkins. So yeah, that would be my two kind of year two picks.
I would totally agree. We were kind of saying the same. We were saying that they all stand out because Ronan, didn't know if he was still class in that category. He's been kind of in about it and he's done a lot this year. Judas has been really interesting. Again, it's the same thing. I love when someone's got their own lane, their own vibe, and this is like, there's no one else doing it like Judas is doing it. I know we slagged him earlier on, so it was like Twilight, right? But on a serious, like, he's got his own lane, and I like that. It's something different. We're not just seeing the same generic new guy starting out doing the same thing, whatever that, like, he stands out straight away, and you're like, I know exactly who that is. I know where he's going with it. I see what's happening here. I think that's good, and he's obviously moving that to back it up. That moonsault, when I saw your photos of it, I was like, sweet damn. That was good. Who else would I say? What's his name again? I'm so bad, I forgot his name. Basically, anyone that's trained with Joe Henry, who's the guy that comes out with the gloves again?
Richards.
I can't remember his name, that's so bad.
The guy with the
glove man. The man with the gloves. Yeah, him. He's really interesting too. I kind of like his sort of, I don't know, his vibe. It's a whole thing. Like, I don't know if it's just getting so late now that my brain is just not putting words to my mouth. But again, he's got his own vibe, and I'm like, okay, he's different, he's interesting, but when he actually steps in the ring, he can back himself up. And I think that's there should probably be wrestling school of the year, because you could put a thing in there saying that anyone that's been to Joe Henry schools has, you can tell a Joe Henry student a mile away, and you can tell who's been there. You can see the lads. Like, even then, like, I know, like, just anyone that has talked about being there, like, you can be like, okay, I see the influence. I see how you're wrestling, and you already are at a different caliber to the other guys in the show. And it just stands out. And I think they've got a really good ethic on how they do it. Do you know what I mean? Like, they all seem really nice lads. I haven't saw anyone that's been from that sort of crop that's been a bit of a dick, but.
I quite like the guys from Joe Henry School. So guys from Joe Henry School online on their social media as well, they're fully invested. Like, even if they are going to be, if they're arseholes generally, like Rob Stowe, for example, he's the big bad guy in Disco at the moment. But you know, when you speak to him out with the wrestling environment, you know he's a good lad. Same with Judas, even though you'll hate that I'm saying that. And same with Ryan as well. Again, you'll hate that I'm saying that, but when you see what they kind of bring, that social media aspect, that you know the character of them before you see them on a show, they sell a ticket because of their personality, which is, it's a whole, that's a Joe Henry thing, right?
That's what you need, because I'm not being funny, right? Being a good wrestler is great, and as I said earlier on, like, you can have good matches and good shows, that's cool, but that's not enough. Like, having the online presence, you know who they are. I am invested in the person, so as you said earlier on, you will travel to see someone because you know about them. That's what you want to see. That's like, again, like, put it out there, that was like back in the day, Kyle was trying to get me to go to wrestling, not sure. Then Vago started doing his podcast, so then I started seeing, like, the guys, their personality coming across doing this. I was like, actually, everyone seems pretty, like, interesting. I want to go and see what these guys are actually like as wrestlers, because now I feel like I know them. Like, like who they are a wee bit and stuff. And that's the whole thing. Like at the end of the day, I'm going to sign Pure Deep. We're people. You want to know who you're getting invested in. You want to see, like, are they actually putting it on there? So when you see them online, they're the guys you want to see. Whereas someone who you just see casually, you're like, they might be good, but I don't know anything about you. So I just don't care. Or they're memorable, but these guys are probably going to go pretty far. Because they've got it down. Also, how promoters see them. How can people be expected to be booked in other places if no one knows who they are? Like,
that's true.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think I think that's the interesting thing about his school, is because it's not like associated with a company per se. Obviously, he's close with like a lot of companies like Disco and stuff where he works anyway. But like, it's not like a promotions school, so you'll only see them on those shows. It's like, okay, you can wrestle now. Let's go and see wherever we can get you booked. Another one of his guys, Monstrum, is one of the biggest prospects in terms of a big guy on the Scottish scene. I think that's something that maybe we've been lacking a wee bit. I think Crusher was obviously the big guy, the big monster. It's good to finally have something like that again. But yeah, I think we've kind of mentioned other people. I think Ronan being based in Glasgow now is a huge thing. I think we'll see a lot more of him in different companies across Central Belt, just because it's easier to get to, you know what I mean? I've got a feeling 2024 is going to be a big year for him. That's the ones I've got my eyes on.
Yeah, I mean, the episode will be out by the time this all goes out, but he was saying on where we were speaking that, yeah, he's about 20 minutes away from, or up to an hour away from pretty much everything on the Central Belt. So Attitude Pro, Community Pro, Discovery, just about everything he's about like 10 minutes away from the Community Pro school, not that far away from Joe Henry. So he's planting himself in a position where he can literally take a train to any promotion that he can go to, or take a bus or whatever he needs to do. And in that time, he takes that time to study and work on other things. And he's definitely a guy that people should be looking to get on their shows. 20 years old, ridiculously talented, charismatic. He stopped swearing at shows now, which is good, you know.
That first show, that was so funny. It was the second show ever, wasn't it? The second show? But he swore
his second show, yeah, the one I missed. The one I was there for, but I missed him swearing until I looked back and went, how the fuck did I miss him swearing? Because I was right there next to him pretty much, and he was fucking tremendous. Ronan, even though he did win it in 2022, I think he's a good shout for this year as well. And like I mentioned, Judas, I mentioned Daisy Jenkins as well. She's just someone I really enjoy her social media work, because she goes that throwback 80s vibe, and it's really striking to look at and see. Of the women, I'm trying to think who else. I like Ellie Armstrong as well as our character. Quite interested to see where she goes with kind of how she draws in the veganism for the heel stuff, and then just the plant-based hippiness for the face side of things. Yeah. I think that's really good.
I mean, she's a vegan and a Taylor Swift fan, right?
Oh.
Come on. If that's not the biggest monster heel in the world, come on, let's go.
Not a Taylor Swift fan. Do you know what I think is interesting, again, to take it from the women's side of it? Again, I'm going to drop it again. The fact that there's people that Bailey really enjoys, and Bailey's like, oh, I want to know more about them, is interesting. So Bailey really liked Ellie, because she was, when they did the show over the fort, like the outdoor shopping centre at ours, and Bailey was like, oh, who's she? Like, really interested, really like it and stuff. Who else is it she liked? She likes Angel Hayes, but she's been doing it for a while, so that doesn't count. She loves Casey, that doesn't count. She can't be an up and coming. She's done it all. But again, things like that, I think it's really interesting to see it from like a young girl who's potentially looking at wrestling. I think that's interesting to see who stands out for her as well.
Absolutely. Good. Tag team, one to watch. Last year was the Fair City Saints. I think we've pretty much covered a lot of it in the tag team of the year chat. Mine would probably be guys like Casino Brutal, Arcade Violence would probably be thrown in there as well. I'm trying to think of other like ones to watch. Skull Brawl, I suppose we could throw them in there as possibly, because now they're teaming in Discovery and seems to be in WrestleZone as well. See what Connor and Ronan do year upcoming year. I suppose, because Davey will probably point out Tag Team of the Year, I probably should have mentioned the Govan team as well when we were talking, because they're just kind of mental for them. But yeah, one to watch. Yeah, probably a couple I throw in there. So Gervin's, the Gervin boys.
Gervin boys.
That's true, actually. I forgot they were tagging together now.
Up and coming, brand new to the scene, The Purge.
Shut up. They're new.
I don't know where you're from. Who else? The coffee's still cutting a bit. Yeah, it's not a thing.
NXT.
Full of promotions.
Anyway,
no.
Let's not. I'm really excited for the two you said there. Let's just move on. I think the Connor and Ronan thing is going to be great. Like, everyone knows they two work amazing together. Interesting though, because I know it was kind of like, for a while, everyone kind of said that would be a perfect tag team. And I felt like Connor was starting to get so much momentum. Like, they were really angling towards something was going to happen. They were going to push him. And now it's Ronan. And I don't know, I think they'll do well together. But for me, I was excited to see what Connor was going to do on his own. Connor had so much to give. And with, again, him training in different places, I think he's doing so much to put in another tag team where he just came out of a tag team. Not just out, I know it's been a while, but really, what has he got to do in that time period? I felt like he's not really had a lot of kind of filler matches here and there. And the matches he's had have been really good. Like, I'm not dismissing that, but he's not had anything to really work towards. He's not really had a real feud. He won the sort of like ladder match, and he just had the match, and that was it. Like, nothing really came of it. Do you know what I mean? I think he needs something a bit more. Do you know what I mean? And I don't think Ronan's not going to hold him back. I think, ironically, even though they'll be really good together, I think they're going to hold each other back. I think they could do more on their own.
I will say though, the one thing I think is maybe a thing with Connor. I've not realised it until now. I think he suffers a little bit from Zach Dynamite syndrome, which is that he was presented as a good guy, but he does look like a bit of a prick sometimes, right? Mm. And I love Connor, right? So I'm sure he'll accept that. But you know, I mean, like, he's too nice. He's too, like, do you know what I mean? Like,
it's too nice. That's why people should hate him.
It's like when Zach Dynamite used to do this, like, back in like 2013. He'd come out and he'd be like, "I like that guy," but he'd be like, "Yeah, let's go."
Kayleigh hated him. Kayleigh thought he looked so sleazy. There's that.
That's the thing. And I think if they just let Connor, he could do it as well. Skullbro, can't wait. Like, honestly, see if it's just for the videos alone. Don't even need to wrestle. Wrestling will be good. Don't even care about that part. I'm just invested in the stories that we're getting from them. These videos, like, love them. Every time I see that they've uploaded a new video together, I'm like, right, get it watched. Mm-hmm. So funny.
So yeah, I think it's gonna be an interesting one. I think, like you said, Kyle, you were saying that just in general, 2024, end of 2023 seems to have fizzled out for a lot of things, but 2020 it's built up a lot for 2024. I think that's the same for tag teams as well. Because hopefully we see the likes of Casino Brutal maybe make their way up our end of the country, even if it's against, like, because Foundation versus Casino Brutal is money on the table somewhere. I don't know if it's happened as a 2-on-2 anywhere, but that would be class. Should mention the outfit as well, maybe, because they went from a team that I don't think many people really cared about because they were kind of the lackeys for the majority of 2022, and then they got Ted back and the crowd somehow embraced them because they were up against the absolute bastards that were the Foundation of the Future, and they won the tag titles at Christmas Chaos. So give them a shout, possibly that they make sneak in somewhere, whether it's the tag team of the year or one to watch, whether someone will, whether Ted will vote for himself, I don't know. We'll soon find out. Not that I know, I don't keep email addresses, so I won't be able to know if it's Ted O'Keefe at AOL.com. That votes. I like Ted. Just something about. I think I like making fun of him more. You know, I think it's just that kind of relationship we have. Yeah. I hope he agrees. I hope he knows it's a good fun, or he blocks me again. One to watch promotion. So, last year was Iron Girders. In the past, it's been Fair City Wrestling. WrestleZone's been in there. Fierce Females. Oh my, Fierce Females. That was a thing. Was 2020. So this year, I'm trying to think of one. So, don't know, really. A lot of promotions are bleeding gums, I suppose, would be one you'd throw in there.
Is the only one. Yeah. Everyone else is established.
I will say, I think if you're taking away like new promotions, obviously that's pretty much it. And obviously Attitude Pro is a relatively new promotion. If you're thinking about like maybe more established promotions that are like hoping to maybe take a next step, I think, you know, CPW will be an interesting one, because yeah. I think their goal this year was just to like have more shows and be more consistent with that sort of thing, and I think they've knocked out the park. So I think the fact that they've got Santino Marella booked already for next year says like their mission statement for next year is just to go bigger.
You could actually say, and this isn't something I say often, be interested to see what ICW do. See, yes. Since they're changing their whole thing, like, we can call a spade, like, we used to go all the time, fail off from it and stuff, whatever, but I think it's interesting that they've finally looked in the mirror and realised where they're at. Do you know what I mean? Like, I feel it just wasn't working for a while, and that was a big thing. It just wasn't working what they were doing. I think they really, like, back to the drawing board and realise what actually made them them. So it'd be interesting to see how it plays out when they do their like, sort of one-off shows, because that could be something again. There's that gap in the market with the. You have a lot of family-friendly shows just now, which is class. You don't really have much else. That's why it's interesting. We've now got Bleeding Gums. We've now potentially got ICW back to have that bit more of a grittier wrestling, because we are missing it. We had loads of it for a while, and then we've got none. For many reasons. But it could be good to see what happens when that comes back. Is that going to be another sort of like gap? So I would say they're one to watch.
I mean, I think, well, CCW obviously changed to Valor Pro Wrestling or whatever it is now, which makes sense because half their shows aren't in Copenhagen anymore. That could be an interesting one with the rebrand, and like they're doing a lot more shows in the UK, between like the North East England and obviously like Central Belt, dependent on the random venues they run, whether it's Kirkintilloch or Lochwinnock or the Grand Opry in Glasgow.
It's a great venue, by the way.
Yeah, that show looked fun.
Great venue. I saw their drag show the other week. Looked amazing too.
So yeah, I mean, they're possibly one as well.
Throw in W3L as well, because do you see they were announced, they're now putting special events on the Progress on demand. So
I saw that.
We'll see if bringing in more Progress guys to their shows, because I think that was it Tate Mayfair's Nina Samuels. So they're bringing in established talent from Progress onto their shows, which yeah, I think that's going to be interesting to keep an eye on and see who they bring up for them and see how that relationship goes. Because imagine the madness of, I mean, they come up to Elgin twice a year, but the thought of like seeing, I don't know, Luke King Sharp against Cara Noir or something, you know? So you're just like sitting there going, this is mental. Why is this happening? But because of that relationship, there's that possibility. And vice versa, Luke King Sharp on Progress. Fucking go for it. Why not?
I mean, they book a few guys that I like. Like, obviously, you've got Iceman and Jack that they've had on shows recently, who are some of the soundest guys you'll ever meet. Am I right in saying, or is it Valor that I've had Lou Nixon? I know there's a couple of promotions that I've been bringing him up as well. Like, both, just yeah. Folk that you don't necessarily see a lot of in Scottish wrestling, which is nice, because you always get the same old people that everyone brings up from England. But then, like, if you look at it, like, you've got like Disco, got G Money, which is quite unique to them. Like, no one else really books him in Scotland, and like, it's nice to see some new faces in places because it gives you a reason to watch it.
That's the thing as well. Like, again, it's nice. It feels like, see, the end of this year and beginning of next year, it's as if like it's going back to that area. There was kind of only a couple of places wrestling kind of took a bit of a lull again, but we're starting to get that vibe back. Like, there seems to be a bit of a hype around wrestling again, and sometimes, ironically, you need to have some people that are only in one area. Again, I'm going to mention ICW. That was one of their things. It was people, you could only see them at their shows, so you'd go out your way to see them because they was where they were. And you've got that, and I think there's a level, like, sometimes Wrestle's on, I think, something that's good, but also to their detriment. They have the same people all the time, which is class. but I think some of their configurations, they've kind of ran as far as they can with some of their configurations. I would love to see a wee bit of a fresh meat in there, just to give it a new spark. So there's the it's leveling it out, but again, having more of these places that have like a working relationship where you'll get maybe exclusives, a reason to tune into them. It can only do great. Do you know what I mean? Like, it'll give you something to watch.
Yeah, we've got like Iron Girders have announced Jonathan Gresham for next year coming in.
How random!
Which is insane. And it's things like that are quite like it's a unique draw to like a show like obviously Santino. In CPW as well, like you've got a few of those things already for early next year, where there's like unique people coming in, which is nice. It doesn't have to be an import, obviously, but yeah, it's interesting.
Yeah, but what CPW bringing is French lads as well. So clearly that Davey's caught some connections while he was like gut check and all that kind of stuff. He's found some new faces as well that you can throw in. So yeah, absolutely. There's quite a few now that we've spoke about it, that one to watch category can really, because it's just a wide open question, it can be literally like a new business relationship or a new promotion. It's a very, very interesting one. The last award that we've got is one that I have passed on to everyone to vote for, because I can't think of one particularly this year, or I've thought of several, which is our Outstanding Recognition Award for Extraordinary Service, so aka our Hall of Fame. So I've picked them the last 7 years. So we've had likes of Grado's gone in, Lionheart went in 2019, 2020 Joy Lyons went in when he retired, then he came back, so, and he's retired again by the time this episode comes out, because I think his last match is tonight.
Oh, big fan of him, by the way, big fan of him. See, when I found out he knew who I was, made me giggle. I didn't think anyone knew who I was. Love that man.
Johnny's amazing. Especially, have you watched the Vagal podcast with Omar? Yeah.
Not yet.
No. Well, they talk about that review I did for W3L Action Academy, where I ripped everyone apart during it. And I talked about, what if Johnny saw it? It's like, Johnny saw it. And I went to see the wrestling that week that I put it out, because he was doing Union Square. And I was only there to take a couple matches I went through for the day. I thought, I'll see a couple of matches. When I went down, it was Aspen versus Johnny. So I was buzzing, because that's the match probably I would have wanted to see when I was there. And he immediately jumped out of the ring, came over the barrier towards me, and I was shitting myself. So I thought, oh no, oh no. And he just came and went, oh, I totally agree. I don't know why Mike's put that up. Oh, fuck. Thank God. Last thing I want, because Johnny's loud, the last thing I want is Johnny Lyons to rip me apart in the middle of Union Square. Because I think I would just shit my pants right there. Then I go, I'm going home. I'm going home now. Kayleigh, take me home. So anyway, Outstanding Recognition Award for Extraordinary Service. So I've got four people that you can choose from. So it's a straight up vote this year. I'm not asking for nominations. So usually I put it to someone who's made a name for themselves in Scottish wrestling, and because of them, they influence this Scottish wrestling now. So it's more modern. It's not like George Kidd or any of that like old school kind of guys. So this year I've put in Kayleigh Ray, Viper, Stevie Boy Xavier, and I've forgotten the last. I think it's Liam Thompson. Liam Thompson is the fourth one. So
it's not going to be him then. We forgot about him. He's crossed him.
So, okay. So I think it's Liam Thompson. I'll go back and probably add him just in case I haven't. So that's the four that I put forward, because I thought they're guys that don't wrestle in Scotland now, but they were a big part of the initial boom when back in 2014 when the Fight Club documentary came out and all that kind of stuff. And they're no longer active in Scotland itself, even though WWE come to Glasgow, etc. Don't ignore that bit. So that's the four that I've put forward, up to people to vote. I think probably if I was voting for it, because I wasn't sure, I was on the fence about those ones, I'd probably put Kayleigh Ray, but again, I wasn't sure, so that's why I've put it to the public to vote this year for the Hall of Fame. So if it goes spectacularly wrong, I will pick it myself next year.
Yeah, well, like I said, I think Kayleigh's the best shout. I think for actual wrestling, she's done so much. Every type of match, she's showcased different versions of herself, but also on a different level. Do you know how many people that I've heard have been influenced to take up wrestling because of Kayleigh Ray more than any other wrestlers on there as well? Like, there's so many of them that have said that they were influenced or they want to do it because of her. And when you also, like, when you find out the things she was doing outside the ring and she still managed to do all that plus wrestle in the way she did, I think that she deserves a lot more recognition than she does. It's a shame she doesn't get used too much where she is. The things that she has been able to do over in America just now is amazing. And anytime I see her, I get really excited to see her. She's one of those people that I still, if I see Kayleigh is going to be on the show, I will watch it. I'll go out my way, even if I don't normally watch like NXT or whatever, I'll watch it because she's going to be on there. She just never know what you're going to get from her, which I think is something more. Again, everyone else is good. Liam Thompson, cool. Stevie Boy, again, good. A lot of good matches and stuff. Viper as well. A lot more, like, especially lately, a lot more personality than anything, which is great. But I wouldn't necessarily tune in just to see them for the sake of it. She's the only person I'm like, I would go out my way still to this day to be like, I'm going to watch it because she's on it. And same then, if it's like any matches, I'm like, I'm going to watch it because you don't know what you're going to get with her. So I think that she's probably the best. Like, influenced a lot of people.
Yeah, because I don't think I can really argue with that at all. So, but no, I put it to the people. So if I've forgotten Liam Thompson, if people vote for Liam Thompson in their droves, then he goes in. So, which again, I don't think any of them are bad shouts, but yeah, there's probably ones that are a bit more weighted than others in your mind. Right, Kyle, you have no thoughts on that other than I've forgotten Liam Thompson. So, is that just you agree?
Yeah, I mean, yeah,
You,
Kayleigh
or
is
you don't
nice. I
care.
mean, it's not happy, don't worry. Yeah, I think Kayleigh is probably the best shout out of those four. I mean, they all have a good argument for why. I mean, if you're talking like impact, I think Viper is probably the top one though, because like the stuff she's doing now, like she's on TV every week, pretty much. Do you know what I mean? Like on the main roster of WWE, which is insane. Like, I remember the first time you thought of, I remember getting excited for people being extras on Raw back in the day when they'd come to the UK, and now you've got people who are legitimately members of the main roster. Share a match on SummerSlam. Do you know what I mean? Like,
That was mental.
that's the crazy part. Do you know what I mean? So like, yeah, I think all four have got valid reasons to be in there. I think if we're talking, you know, the stuff they're doing now, legacy wise. You know, those two are probably your top shouts, just because the other two haven't obviously been active. But again, they've all brought a lot to the scene. Do you know what I mean? If it wasn't for Liam Thompson, we wouldn't have got the housekeeping matches that we had in SW, which are some of the best matches I've ever seen.
Yeah, I mean, now thinking about it, I mean, possibly, I think if he made it to the main roster, if he makes it to the main roster next year, I'd probably have Noam Dar as well hanging about in that kind of
Yeah.
category because he's done so much for the scene. I mean, one of the probably one of the most viewed matches online or one of the most referenced matches is him versus AJ Styles. So you know, he's been around for a long time, and now he's seems to be a moment in NXT that people really enjoy watching and the silliness that the metaphor produced. So hopefully if he makes it into the main roster next year, I'd probably throw him into a shout for this particular
Do you know something though?
award.
I would argue the fact that he might not be in the main roster, but he's one of the main reasons that people tune in to NXT, and he's one of the main things people look for. Or for a long time, he was one of the main things people were looking for, like online. That was the thing that everyone was talking about. So I would say, even though he didn't make the main roster, he's one of those guys, controversially, I don't want him on the main roster. He's one of those people that I think would get ruined. I think he works better in an NXT environment than there. I'm not going to like deprive the lad of it, but I think like take it like Finn Balor, right? I know he's doing well now, but he was someone that sees him up to the main roster. It just wasn't the environment for him. He was better on the sort of NXT vibe, and I think someone like Noam Dar is the exact same. I don't think he
I mean, he's been there already.
would be used properly. I think he's someone there, so I would argue actually. His legacy is amazing just now. The stuff with the Heritage Cup, that's his. Like, that's his own thing. Do you know what I mean? So I see that actually he's a contender to be put in this just now.
I mean, he's already been on the main roster, and they just used him to say Fox, funny. So I mean, you could argue Yeah, maybe going to the main roster isn't the best thing for him. But yeah, he's definitely a shout, isn't he? I always forget about him,
Put
weirdly
on
enough.
great matches.
But it is funny because he's probably one of the reasons I got into like local Scottish wrestling, because like I knew about the sort of indie stuff and like Ring of Honor and all that sort of stuff, and then you start watching matches on YouTube, and then you watch AJ Styles versus Noah Hannum, of all companies that got me into British wrestling. He was obviously a big deal in there, and then you find out about stuff, you know, that sort of stuff. So yeah, I mean, that's an interesting show as well. I know he wasn't on your list, but it's an interesting one.
You know what? That was a very convincing argument. I'm going to put him in there. So it's now five options to choose from. It's Kayleigh Ray, Stevie Boy Xavier. It was Liam Thompson, Viper, and Noam Dar. So there you go. Five choices that are yours and yours alone to pick for our Hall of Fame this year. And next year, we'll probably do what the Dave Meltzer thing does. Put them all, the four that are left, and throw in a fifth one next year until Big Daddy goes in. Seems to be the way things work. So we've got that. So before we wrap up, because we've went through all the award categories this year, and we've been here for over 2 hours, I'm just going to announce to you guys the top 10 of the SWN 150. Even though it will be out for about 4 days now, but if people don't go on the website, then I'm telling you now. So yeah, 150 names this year. I could have done 200, but it gets a bit weird because of the five match threshold. So like, if Martin Kirby had five matches and he won five matches, then he gets a higher total because he's undefeated. So it kind of skews things. It starts looking silly. So anyway, so the vote criteria for those that are curious, it is at least five matches across our future promotions. We feature like 18 promotions. We follow the criterion that includes win loss record, championships won, championships retained, number of future promotions worked for, and match and wrestler of the month results. Judging period was December 1st, 2022, November 30th, 2023. I have a massive Excel spreadsheet. It was a fucking pain in the arse to keep updated each month. So if you have any problems with it, fuck off. It took me ages to make. So far, from our records, 460 wrestlers had at least one match this year. 207 had five matches across that threshold. So yeah, I've had a I need to have a better system next year because this was not good. So in 10th place is Logan Smith. He was 16 last year. I mean in numbers, not in age. Moxie Malone in 9th, who was 82 last year.
Mother?
In 8th place, Zach Dynamite, who was 5th last year. Number 7, Levi, who was 76.
Very good.
Six is Spike Tierney, who was not listed last year. Fifth is Brody Adler, who was 65 last year. Fourth is Taylor Bryden, who was number one. Third, Thatcher Wright, who was 54. Second is Lost Boy Aspen, who was 23. And in first place, who was third last year, is Caleb Valhalla. So
Ooh.
statistically, Caleb Valhalla has been the best wrestler in Scotland this year.
Yes, that makes sense to be fair. Like, the lad deserves it. Come on.
There's that. If it helps your voting for Wrestler of the Year, what have you, there it is. So go check out the website. I will have the full 150 on there. There's some interesting ones thrown in there. Some
Who's 100?
Yeah, who's 150? That's the
it's
one I want.
Seb Silvers from community from Copenhagen Championship Wrestling. So he had quite a good year there, and he was in WCL as well.
That's one you care about, isn't it? It's like the PWI one. It's who's last and who's top.
Just because you're gonna ask, Charlie Rose is number 69 as well.
Who was you most surprised with? Who were you surprised at where they ranked? Was
As
there?
far as like ranking high, I was surprised that Ian Skinner was 163, and I was kind of surprised by that. But then when I thought about it, he's been doing most of his wrestling down south, so that made kind of
Yeah,
makes sense.
losing. No, he just loses all the time, you
Yeah.
know. Duh. Duh.
Nothing really kind of shocked me. It's just seeing some of the names like from Target, because Target run quite frequent shows. So a lot of Target names are in there because they've got more matches, I suppose. As far as drop off, Kez Evans went from number 7 to 75, which, because he didn't wrestle a lot this year, which is just the way it works, I suppose. Troy Lyons at 92, Mickey Vago at 98, so I've kept it at the 100, then could have had Vago right near the top of that. So it was really shocked me, to be on it. Ken O'Keefe's on, Mr. WrestleZone's on it, the 150 as well, so goes to show how legitimate this is. Lewis Garvin, 119. So he's there. So yeah, it's an interesting list. So people go check that out. So in the meantime, this has been a beefy episode of the SWN podcast for the 29th of December. I didn't think we'd be here for over 2 hours, but the time has flown by.
Did we not have any questions?
Oh shit! So we did. Fuck's sake! What a terrible host I am. Right. We got a few. Right, we'll go to Instagram first. Ian Skinner's already asked his question. You'll be glad to know I'm not going to ask again. We have Daniel Mejka asking, is it acceptable to have a Terry's chocolate orange for breakfast on Christmas Day? Yes.
Yeah, it's Christmas. Right. You can eat.
Be an adult. Eat what you want when you want.
Ass.
Have it tomorrow, you know? 30th of December. Chocolate orange.
Go for ass? Oh. You have an ass tomorrow, Billy? God sake.
Wait, what?
Weird.
I feel like I missed something there.
Next question.
Okay. I'm scared to listen back to this now. Xander, our cousin Xander here asked, Mike Rushmore of mid-card or finishers?
Mid-card finishers.
I'm going to just go with D'Lo Brown's frog splash for one.
Yeah, do you know a move I just don't care for? Right, controversial. Maybe it's the era I grew up in. I just a wee leg drop. Is that a finisher?
I mean, it's not really a mid card finisher either. It's
but it should be. That's shit.
One pretty much every title.
Yeah.
annoyingly, JBL becoming a main eventer ruined that answer because the clothesline from hell used to ruin people. I mean, you've got X-Pac, the
Beller Buster.
Yeah.
So a good finisher for a mid-carder. Would you say Baron Corbin's a mid-carder?
Yeah.
Because it says End of Days.
End of Days is good, actually.
Amazing.
Yep. Yeah. Dominator, Rook.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yes. Anything Gangrel does.
I was going to say Impaler DDT. Something? Throw that in.
See if you go back, right? Because I did this recently. See if you go back and watch his debut when he comes out. First of all, his boots. I would love a wee Amazon link to buy them. The man is one of the best wrestlers that you've saw in that era, and I stand by it. He's in my boys' club. Like, he's up there.
So there's four.
I'll die now.
D'Lo Brown's Frog Splash, Gangrel's Impaler DDT. I can't remember there are two that we just spoke about.
Baron Corbin's End of Days.
There was another one. I forgot. Well, I'm still through the clothesline from hell. I think it was because he was main event for what, a year, but he was still JBL. He never really thought of as a main eventer. Once he lost the belt, he was shuffled back down again quite quickly. So I would still say clothesline from Dominator. That was our one. Dominator.
Yes.
There we go. Right. So that's Instagram ones. Twitter. Alan has asked best pop punk Christmas songs.
Did a bit of research on this earlier. I was like, I can't remember what ones there was, right? But Fall Out Boy did one on their greatest hits album called You'll Shoot Your Eye Out, but it's like Yule, as in like Yuletide. That's a good one. You obviously mentioned
December by Neck Deep is my favourite. And you can have the normal version or the slow version.
And then you've got the last one I mentioned is Happy Holidays, You Bastard. By Blink, which is the one about the grandpa and all that. Those problematic things that he says on that call. Yeah. That song.
Oh, what's that song again? Oh, it's not really pop punk though. What's that Australian comedian that does all the weird Christmas songs?
Did mention?
If I remember, I'll tell you later. But he's full.
No,
he's like something like Fuck You Santa or something like that. My dad just plays all the time. I'll find it and give it to you.
Do you think Tim Minchin is like a perfect of Judas Grey and Sam Barber?
Right. I think, what are you on?
Just a little bit.
No, no, no. Like, I can't even pretend. Like, even the cat's staring at you. You can't see this just now, but the cat's just staring at him.
I'll throw in I Won't Be Home for Christmas, which is Blink as well. I'll throw that in there, I suppose.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, the other one's kind of been answered. Stephen asking who'll have the biggest breakthrough in women's wrestling next year. Kind of cover that a little bit. Well, we didn't really, because we only mentioned like one women's wrestler for the one to watch. But yeah, Daisy, Ellie Armstrong, that's probably the top two shouts, I would say. Moxie as well.
I mean, Kayleigh, she somehow convinces Andrew to let her in a death match. You know, could be the next champ, you know.
I don't get it, sort of thing. She's a wrestler, so it's fine.
Every single year, I tell myself I'm going to do the wrestling, right? And then every year, I'm like, it's not for me. I've decided, right? See, be an actual wrestler. Isn't my calling. I need to be realistic about this. So I would like to do it. I'd love an opportunity one day to either just be involved in some sort of capacity. Do you know what I mean? I could take something to the ring. I could be entertaining on the outside.
Dennis Stamp.
I could entertain people. I could be ring announcing. I don't know. I could do something.
I'm not booked.
I don't know. I realise in the ring, no for me. Outside the ring, just having a bit of banter, that's more my calling. I'd take it too far. But yeah. I don't know. There's not a lot of women wrestlers that have, like, all the ones I've saw, I've not saw many of them wrestle this year. They're already pretty established. So there's not many I could say that are, like, up and coming necessarily.
But yeah, so I think that's it. That is definitely all the questions. I don't think I got any through Facebook. So I'm assuming that's it. If there's any more, ask them directly. Go through the Instagram and or go through the K&K Wrestle Factory Twitter for the questions to fester for who knows how long. But this has been a big meaty episode of the SWN podcast. I hope people have listened. They've gotten through my coughing. They got to hear Ian Skinner be Ian Skinner for a bit. And yeah, listened to what our thoughts were, even though you probably ignore me and vote for someone else. I swear to God, if someone puts Bobby Roberts for Wrestler of the Year, I will I'll hunt you down and I will find you.
Him? We'll probably have him and all his pals vote for himself. Like,
He's too busy getting about fucking deathmatch wrestling, you know, even though someone, you know, slices a heat open in front of kids in the community centre. But anyway.
And with that, let's go. So yeah, thank you for watching. Thank you for listening. Merry Christmas has passed. Happy New Year. Have a good one. Bye.